All right, so I'm back. I checked the last stream, and despite the message, there was nothing wrong with it. It just was throwing me a bad message, so I reviewed it and it was fine. So, all right, we're gonna get going here. I want to build a powertrain, so essentially engine transmission. A lot of people have been struggling with transmissions. One of the reasons my videos are a little bit longer, especially my tutorials, is I often see this where there are like 20 tutorials that are like 5 minutes long. And the person building it isn't explaining why something works. They're just making it work so that you can get it done in 5 minutes. And so sometimes that's fine. You get a quick 5 minute video, tells you how to do something. I put some of those out myself that they're quick and it just tells you, hey, do X, Y, and Z. It doesn't explain to you why X, Y, and Z work, which for certain applications is fine. The problem is when you get into more complex issues, like for example, making a transmission, actually understanding why gearing works, you need a little bit of explanation because what I often see is somebody will watch a 5 minute tutorial and then they'll jump on Reddit, they'll jump on Steam, they'll jump on the Discords, and they'll ask people for help af and they're already frustrated because they've spent the last 2 hours trying to figure it out on their own. They're not getting anywhere. They get frustrated. Then now they're agitated and they're on Reddit, they're on Steam, they're on the Discords asking for help. Hey, how's it going, Tomcat? And so they're asking for help because the video did not go into good explanation of why something works, why something doesn't work, if it didn't go into the theory of it. So my philosophy is I'd rather make an hour-long video that's comprehensive. And if you want to go watch a 5 minute video, go watch a 5 minute video. But then you can also, if you want, watch an hour-long comprehensive video and you actually understand why something works. And if you understand, okay, I'm overloading my engine, need a bigger engine. Okay, I can build that. Where if somebody with a 5 minute video, you're like, I have no clue why this isn't working. And it's just frustration. And then you're asking 20 people who didn't make the video how to fix this thing. And they really have no idea either. And so I tend to like to make a little bit more comprehensive. So let's go ahead and we'll get in there. Just a little philosophy on why I do things the way I do and why my videos are so long. But let's go ahead. And so this is going to be a truck car engine, doesn't really matter. Let's go ahead and start building this up. I'm trying to think what I want for size wise. Let's make it a flat six. So I'm going to make a bunch of these and put them out as modules. I should turn on symmetry here. I'll leave symmetry off for now. I'm going to probably not use it right away. All right, so I want my belt drive. Where you at there, guy? There you are. Okay, belt drive. And so it is. It's going to be a car transmission. I released the Eaton Fuller 10 and 18, and somebody immediately in the comments was like, can you do it like a four speed? So I have been planning on putting out these engine transmission combinations so that people can use them. So I figured I'd do it. And so let's go ahead and start getting this plumbed up. And then we want starter, alternator. And then we'll try to grab a, we'll just do a three by raid on this. I don't mind using these electric radiators for cars. Because cars would have an electric radiator, I tend not to like to use them on, like airplanes and stuff because they'd be air cooled. But I'll use them just because we can't get proper air cooling in there a lot of the time. So that's plugged in. Okay, let's go ahead and probably do. It's a little bit of a pain with the flywheel there. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, they look good for cars where, I understand some people use them just because they're the most efficient, but I like to try to keep thematic, especially like aircraft. I like to use air cooling if I can. Sometimes I just can't as I can't get enough cooling out of them. All right, so let's grab a T-piece pipe here. And the big thing with the flywheel is so big, it cuts through my footprint here of where I want to be. But we have to go to the wheels anyway, so this is tends to be when I set this up. So we can go here post transmission. Let's do post transmission. All right, so kind of small side transmission, what I like to do is I can do a couple. One is I can box it in or I can run it long wise. And so let's try to decide how I want to get this transmission kind of out. So I've been doing a sideways four. The problem is I'm trying to keep it in a tight footprint so people can just drop it in their cars. So let's go like this. Let's see how tight I can get this. The problem is I really can't get it all that tight in here. Yeah, see, I'm gonna have to, let's see. I might be able to get all four gears. I'm just trying to keep it kind of compact. Probably not gonna be, I'll probably have to just do it straight at the back. Yeah. Or do it as a kind of a for loop here. Been doing for loops to great effect before, so let's see. Yeah, see, that's gonna extend past the boundary. So let's just do a straight one for now, at least. We'll do straight out transmission. All right, so generally what I'll do is when it's touching the ground, I like them being away. Trying to keep this reasonable for people, so we'll do away towards. Do it like that. You know, this way you can, you know, this will be under the hood, and then you can sit on top of the transmission, which is pretty normal because you'd normally have your linkage through there if you were linking, doing linkage. All right, so there's my four gears there. I could tighten this in a little bit if I go wrap around, but I'm not going to because again, I have to kind of think of people's dashes too, so I'm trying to make it so people can just drop it in and utilize it. So there's the gearing there, and then what I want to do is probably drop it down and tee it. It's always best in game to run all-wheel drive if you can, just because the for the grip for the game is best in this way. So I'm just gonna put some T pieces there just so people can easily tell where the wheels are gonna go. How many hours do I have in Stormworks? Let me look. Why is the game not in windowed mode now? That's weird. 4632. Yeah, see, why is this not in? I have like a separate program for this. See, it should be in full screen window. That's probably why. Okay, that's what it was the game was complaining last. The stream was complaining. Let me know if the stream has any issues in the next little bit. I have a program that fixes the window. Just let me know if it is screwed up. I tested it and was fine before. All right, so that's kind of our engine. Let's go. We need to start putting the rest of the parts on here. So because it's a flat engine, it's going to need manifold pieces to go through. And so let's go ahead, stick them here. All right. And let's go ahead and I'll just do a cross piece there. So it'll be a flat six. And then I need to put a T piece in here. It's not gonna work there, is it? Not really. Let's see. So I'm gonna supercharge it too. I'm just trying to currently get this kind of where I want it. Trying to keep the footprint kind of on the light end here. That's probably pretty far back for wheels anyway, so I think it's going to go one block further forward anyway. Let's get rid of that for now. That's just kind of in the way. Propeller. All right. All right, so let's do it like this. Trying to kind of figure out where I'm getting put my impeller in here. So that matters for where things go after that. Now what's that? That is fluid in. Okay. Let's see. Air manifold will go here. And then I think we'll stick fuel on this side. And then exhaust there. Okay, good. So I'm just trying to kind of piece together where I want stuff at the moment. That's just screwed. Okay, that's fine. I can go over the top there. So I'm just figuring stuff out where I want it here. So let's go. Where you have their fuel manifold. Alright, and that will get the fuel in there like so, and then exhaust can come down. Alright, and I'll just show people where the exhaust goes. Alright, so that's kind of plumbed in. Let me see. Alright, have a good one there, Tomcat. Alright, so that is kind of plumbed up, and let's go ahead and see what else we need here. So we need some manifold pieces on the top to tie the backs together. Alright, so the backs are now tied. Alright, good. So that's set up, and main focus here is getting this transmission set up. So let's start working on... I'm going to make the panel from... I always do this, So I'm trying to make everything modular now so that I can more easily get things put out. And so one of the things is I was keep stealing panels off other builds, and I'm trying to build one from scratch. So this will be the Pat Flat 6. All right, so that's my flat 6. Let's go. All right, so just trying to do more modular stuff so that everything just kind of flows better. All right, so this is going to be composite input panel. Composite input seat, and then... I'm going to leave a space for the panel. I might not add it, just that way if somebody wants to have panel control, they can. And then this is going to be the input for the engine. All right. And then... All right, let's go back here. We want... Number output air manifold. Fuel manifold. I find it easier to not make it a single huge panel, especially with cars, seeing they're very, they do work inside an enclosed space. I believe they work better outside of an enclosed space. Let's see, what was I doing? Number output clutch. All right, it's air fuel number output clutch. Okay. Starter. Alternator. Alternator. Alright. Battery. Alright, let's start with this and see where we get. So, battery, alternator, starter, clutch. And this, we'll go through each part here, and then maybe I'll rip this video apart and do tutorials off of it. I would kind of... been wanting to do a transmission tutorial, and it's brutal because I'm trying to keep it under an hour. But, like, the time really doesn't matter to me. I talked about it earlier is, you know, I think it's better to watch a comprehensive video that explains the concepts, and then you understand why something's not working, than to just take the shortcut and watch a 5-minute video that tells you essentially nothing. And the problem is because you're going to spend the next hours trying to figure this thing out, where if you'd learned it in 1 hour, it would actually take you a lot less time. That's kind of my philosophy with it. All right, so let's get working here. So we want to make the engine work to start with. And so we're going to go and we start with our seat. And I use WS, which is pretty normal. And we're going to make that composite 2 reads WS. And because of the car, we're not worrying about, a car, we don't want it sticky. So we need to put in a function here. And I think what I'm going to do is we'll do, trying to make this configurable so people can configure it. And let's see. All right, so that should give me max and idle. All right, so what we're going to do here is X is going to be our input. Then we're going to do property number. So again, I'm also trying to do this for myself where I can more easily build cars and stuff. So this is going to be our idle. And this is going to be our max RPS. All right. Now, because WS will read a maximum of 1, we can multiply it by whatever we want to get our maximum RPS. So that makes that pretty simple. We'll make the formula easy. So we have idle here. We have that. Next, we're going to go in here and we're going to do clamp. All right. And then we have X, which is going to be our low end value. Or it's going to be our input value from our seat for that. And it's going to be X time. Well, actually, I'll put it in parentheses too. It'll be X times. Was it Z? X times Z, comma. And then idle is going to be Y, comma. And then it is going to be Z. And then that should be good. So what's going to happen is it goes in this clamp. So let's say we want our max RPS to be 30, we'll do 20. 20 RPS. Okay. So when we press W all the way down, we'll get a 1. And so it's going to be 1 times 20 is 20. All right. So we can then go in here. So for example, if I go in here and let's say that's not enough, you can change that to 25. And you can do it right here without having to go in the panel and find it. So that makes that easy. Idle. Let's say we want our idle to be at 3.5 RPS. All right. And so you can set those there. And so what that's going to do is it's going to change it in here so that my lowest value, which will be my idle, would be 3.5. My highest value would be 20. And that's going to be X times 20. So that 0 is 0, of course. 0.1 is going to be 2. And then when I have a 1 as my W, it's going to say, hey, give me 20 RPS. So that's easy. And that gives me a little formula, and you can change it and configure it outside of the panel. All right, so next thing that's going to go in our set point. So that's what we want for our set point. And then we need to bring in RPS. This panel is going to probably have to grow. I'm trying not to have this grow too much. All right, so next is going to be the RPS. So RPS is here. RPS is our process variable. All right, next we need a property number. This is going to be the P value for engine. And I'll start with a 1.8 for that. Nope, 0.18 for that. Now, the way I do these is I don't bother with the D and the I. I don't think it's worth it. It's not worth the time. You don't need it. You don't need that level of precision. People, who don't have a ton of experience with driving or complex driving machinery, they think you need this absolute high level of precision. You don't. And so what I will do is I will overshoot the value I want. So I use a low P value, which eliminates oscillation, but I use a high desired result. So 20 RPS, if I want, say, I don't know, 16 RPS, I'll put 20. If this is too low and I actually am only getting like, let's say I want 20 and I'm only getting 18, pretty simple, put in 22. It's better to do it this way, I find. You get much more reliable results doing it this way. This is why I do it this way. So I know people may ask at some point. You know, I don't need to screw around with D values all day. I don't want to spend 2 hours testing this out. This way works well with changing a simple idle and max limit, and you don't have to worry about it. It just works really well. All right, so let's go ahead and see what else I want to do here. Okay, so the next thing I'm going to do is we'll update this, and I'll save this. And I'll just find my car here. Any of these are fine. Let's see, find the panel. And so this is, I'm going to do all the stoichiometry. Steering, when the hell is the engine? Right here, okay. And so I'm just going to get all the stoichiometry stuff out of here. All right, so it's all this stuff here. And so this goes in here. This is going to do all the stoichiometry stuff. This is going to take care of you for supercharging it, which this will be supercharged. And you don't have to screw around too much. This is all in there. All right, this is going to go to the two X values there. And all you have to do is copy that out and drag it. It says right here, I left the note, X equals throttle. So you plug the throttle from the P value in. So throttle from PID, and that will be a little bit more explanatory there. That's your stoichiometry value of 2 that you want there. It goes through all these formulas. I didn't create all these formulas, other people have, but I've used them. All right, and so trying to not screw my lines up too much. I like my lines all clean and straight, but when I try to build something for other people, I try to make it so you can actually see what the hell, where it's going. All right, so from there, engine goes in here. 1 is air, 2 is fuel, 3 is going to be your temperature. So that's all in there. All right, so that's in there. And then what we need is fuel air. So air is our primary factor. That goes on the top. That goes on the bottom, like so. So that's air and fuel there. So that will get the engine up and running. Starter, we'll work on a second. I'm trying to think how I want to do this. So I could do a panel. I think what I'm going to do is run everything off the seat, and if you want to add panel controls, you can. You know, I think that's the best way to do it because people are going to want different panel controls. That way it makes it just easier, I think. Let's go ahead and see what we're doing next here. So let's work on our starter next. So let's say seat 6 is going to be our starter. So we want to read on off 6. I like 6 just because it's all the way, you know, it's furthest away from your hand. You don't accidentally hit it. So 6. So 6 is going to start our systems. So when 6 is toggled, let's see, do I want to toggle or not? Let's keep it as a toggle. We'll do auto restart. We'll show you how an auto restart works. So 6 is going to toggle on the PID. So that's going to, so if you shut 6 off, it starves the fuel and the air to the engine. Engine shuts off. And so the starter is pretty simple. You need 2 conditions for a start. So if we need 2 conditions, we'll do an and. All right, and we'll go to starter. So what we need is we need 6, and we need to make sure that our RPS is lower than, so what is it? I think it's 2, it's either 2 or 2.5 for a start. So I usually do 2.5. So let's do less than, and this also does auto restart. So if you stall, instead of you having to start the car again, it auto restarts. You can put in systems that don't do that. It's up to you, but I'm just going to do it as an auto restart for now. So if the RPS value is less than, and then we'll do another property number. And this is going to be the start RPS. Starter disengage RPS. Okay, this is going to be starter disengage RPS. That'll be a 2.5. Sometimes that needs to go up higher because with this low P value, sometimes it's going to not be enough. You need to plan on overshoot with this. So that is set up. So 6 is in there. 6 is going to start our PID for our engine. That will also kill our engine. When we do 6, it will start the engine. Once it gets over the sustainability for compression, it's going to automatically shut the starter off. I see a lot of new players, they leave their starters on, and then they ask why I have like 9 generators on my car and it won't stay powered electrically. You should need 1 small alternator and have no problem with your electricity in a car. All right, so that is now the starter dealt with. Let's do auto clutch. So I've done auto clutch many a time here, so let's do that. So the way you do a clutch in real life, a lot of people are losing that skill set because manual cars are going away, unfortunately. And so it's different in game because it's backwards. You know, you let go of the clutch pedal, you actually get maximum application of the clutch. And so the clutch is designed to slip. You know, I saw it on Reddit yesterday. Somebody was talking about why at point three am I getting no clutch? Because that's how it is in real life. You know, in a tractor, for example, you know, a big truck, that kind of tractor for a tractor trailer, it's like the last 1% of your clutch is engagement. Like if I barely push the clutch down, I have no engagement. It's a very small window of the friction zone. And so that's actually really realistic. It's like 10% of the clutch at most is all I use, especially on a tractor, because if you push the clutch pedal all the way down, you get the clutch brake, and you don't want to hit the clutch brake, you'll wear it out. And so that's, you know, so a lot of people are mystified by clutch. So I do auto clutch, so kind of work it backwards here. So we'll go from an up-down counter. Off the top of my head, I think I do 0.001. Okay, so this is where, again, why are my tutorial videos longer than the five-minute one that then makes somebody ask questions for the next 4 hours? I go into detail because I think if you understand the concept, you can solve the problem. So right here with your clutch, so you're trying to control your clutch slipping. And there's something you do called feathering your clutch. So let's say you have a really heavy trailer on a tractor trailer. And I'm trying to get that heavy trailer moving. For example, a set of doubles, it takes a while for the rear brakes to disengage once you've taken your foot off the pedal. So sometimes you're actually dragging the brakes, and the brakes are on a little bit, and you're trying to pull them because you need to go. You just got a green light. And so what you'll do is you'll let out the clutch, let in the clutch, put out the clutch, let in the clutch, and you're feathering it. You're letting some of the power in because the engine needs a certain amount of, in this case in game, RPS to maintain compression. And so what an auto clutch does is it simulates what the driver would be doing of feathering the clutch in and out, in and out, in and out, in and out. And as you start to stall the engine, if you bring the clutch in case of IRL, you put the clutch in, as you start to stall, you want to disengage the clutch and you want to save some of that energy for the engine to maintain compression. And then as you get that compression and torque back, you can then reapply it. And so it's like in, out, in, out, in, out, in, out, in, out, in, go. All right. So that's how it happens in real life. The auto clutch takes care of all that for you. If you're going up a hill, it will feather more. If you're going down a hill, it will feather less. If you have a heavy trailer, it will feather more. If you have not so heavy of a trailer, it will feather less. So that's why I do this auto clutch. So 0.001, enable the clamp, 0 to 1. That's set in there. So we need some conditions. When do we apply this? Well, we need two conditions. When I ask for us to go forward and when we have enough torque to go forward. All right. And so those are the two conditions. So we need some greater thans. All right. So first condition is, do I have enough torque? Do I have enough power to go forward? Am I going to stall my vehicle? So that's a condition off of RPS. And we need another property number. And so this is going to allow you to configure this yourself. So you can go in here, and this is, let's see, clutch application RPS. All right, so this is at what RPS do I think I have enough power to start going forward? And we're going to do start with 4 RPS. We're going to be idling around 3. If we look at our clamp here, I set my idle to 3.5. So once I get up to around 4, I'm going to want to get going. So that's giving it. So we're idling. We're sitting there at a stoplight. We're not doing anything. Okay. We start to increase our RPS. We now have enough power to start moving, and the clutch knows to start applying. All right. And let's see where we're at here. So we have that. And so I need another condition. Let's do an and while I'm here. So let's do... And that goes there. Okay, so that's one condition. Do I have enough power to start moving? That's condition one. All right, the next condition is, do I actually want to get going? Do I want to move? And so what I do with that is, we'll do another greater than. And this one's simple. Is my W key greater than 0? If my W key is greater than zero, I'm saying, hey man, I want to go forward. And so there's two conditions for me to start putting the clutch in there. I'll actually do this so you guys can see a little bit better. There's two conditions. Do I want to go forward, which means my W is greater than zero, and do I have enough power to go forward? And because of the property number, you can change this. If the engine sounds like it's stalling all the time and it's feathering a lot, you can say, okay, well, I need five. I made a cart that has, I think, two gear ratios. It has a one-cylinder engine, and it works by having really long clutch feathering. And so it has to rev really high, and then it feathers the clutch very slowly. In real life, you'd burn out your clutch in a day doing that, but it works in game nicely. And then down here, we have another condition. So all we're going to do here is simple, not. If it does not fulfill these conditions, so if I either don't want to go forward, so I let go of my W key all the way down to zero, or I more realistically, I press my S key, I want to hit the brakes, it's going to start to reduce the clutch. Because when you hit your brakes in a manual car, you need to also press down your clutch. You know, you would do it at a stop, but we're not going into that much detail. So that's going to go there. So it does not fulfill these conditions. It starts to bring the clutch back out, and it starts to separate the clutch plates and make it so that the clutch is no longer engaged. Let's go like that. All right. And so the other one is a reset. So if I have my starter on, I want the clutch all the way out. I don't want to be trying to move the car, turn the engine, do all that crap while the starter is on. I need everything disengaged while the starter is on. In real life, you push the clutch pedal all the way down when you start the starter. So that's what that is doing, making sure the clutch is all the way out. All right, and so let's see. I can also put another condition. I probably will once we get down to, so if the restart is at 2.5, which it is right here, let's do this now. So this is going to be a couple conditions. If my starter is on, it's less than, oh, let me just check this really quick. So I don't want this to stall out. And so what we'll do is it's going to reset my clutch if it's below a certain number. So let's go less than. So if RPS is less than, and then we need a value here. So I want this. So if my idle is going to be at 3.5 and my starter is going to disengage at 2.5, let's say we want this to be 3. And these numbers all change depending on what are you doing. Are you building a truck that needs to haul a heavy weight? Are you building a car that doesn't need to haul a heavy weight? What are you doing? Those numbers can all change. So this here is going to be the, this is going to be the clutch zero RPS. So these can all change depending on stuff. I have a, you know, hundreds of different land vehicles, and they all have different values based on what they do. Trucks, you're going to need different things than you're going to need cars. The truck needs a lot of torque to move something. So for example, if this was a clutch, if this was a truck, this clutch application RPS might be 6 because you need a lot more torque to get the weight of the truck moving. If it's a car, it could be much lower. You know, so those are all things to keep in mind. All right, so the clutch, the auto clutch is done. Alternator, we might as well do it while we're here. Do I have battery coming in here? I don't know. Let me look. Battery right there. Okay, I do. So battery's coming in. So let's do another PID. All right, alternator. All right, and so the 6 key will start the recharge on the engine. That's fine. And then, let's see. Let's do another property. Let's actually just grab this one here. All right, so this is the p-value for alternator. Alternator, okay. And so this one, I'll start with something high for now, and we can tune that in later. 20, where's my battery? I think I left it up here. Okay, battery. So we want the battery is our process variable, and our set point is going to be 1. All right, so our set point is 1. So we want a fully charged battery. This is going to modulate the alternator, so it only gives us as much alternator clutch as necessary to keep the battery at 100%. This makes sure we don't waste it and we don't overload our engine for no problem. You could put a simple one in, people do that, but you're wasting energy and you need a bigger engine because you turn your alternator all the time. It's not a huge deal, but you know, you saw how simple that was. It's simple and it takes care of it for you. You don't have to worry about it. All right, so let's see where we're at here. Let's start updating this and I'll start plugging for now. So we want air manifold, fuel manifold, clutch, RPS, battery. I need a battery. Even my large ships, I do not over battery it. A lot of people are over battering. They just put in enormous batteries for no big reason, no big deal. It adds a lot of cost and weight. You just don't need it. Alternator will go to the alternator pressure here. If I don't have enough alternator to recharge my batteries, I can put another one here. I have space, so. But one should be fine, I'm thinking. Depends on how often we're sitting and what we have for systems going. Battery usage on this should be pretty low because I'm using an engine-driven cooling pump. If I was using an electric one, we have to start worrying about using more. I have an electric radiator that needs to be hooked up at some point. Starter is going on there. Let's see. I think we're mostly set here. Seat, I haven't hooked up yet. And engine. Okay. Let's build a little test stand for this so that we can get going. And I might actually just put wheels on here so people know that they have to where to attach their wheels. Again, you can move any of this piping wherever you want it, but they're on here just, again, to show you what you need to do. And again, this isn't a full car chassis. I will put out a chassis at some point. This is just the engine and the transmission, and you build your own chassis. Eventually, I'll put out a chassis, but that is not what this is at the present. All right, so this is going to go, and that's going to hook up there. Panel. Let's see. Okay. And so this is the WS on there is what we're mainly concerned with. Starter is going to be 6, so that should be toggle. That should be start slash stop. Engine. All right, so when it's a start slash stop here, it is a toggle button, so you press 6. Engines will start up and run. When you want to shut off your engine, press 6 again, and everything will stop. So that's hooked in there. All right, let's do electricity here. So let's see. Battery. For right now, I'm just going to direct connect everything. So we have starter. We'll just direct connect everything for now. I'm not going to... I don't want to get into panels again. That's not what this is about. It's not like a... Like, I have a car here, if you look... That is my car module right here. When I build all my cars, I start with this. That's everything connected. That's not what I'm trying to do here. I'm just trying to make the engine and transmission so you can put it in your own cars and you can determine how you want to set up the rest of it. I don't want to put too much junk where you start getting how I want to do it. I want this part, this type of build to be, okay, you put this in your own thing and it's your, you know, you can decide how you want to do everything else. All right, so that is in. Let's go ahead and... Am I missing anything? Let's check everything really quick. I want to make sure I can get a start out of this. All right, so let's spawn this and check it. Infinite electric's off and fuel is off. I don't have fuel on there, so I'm not going to get a start. Let's get that going. Not where you at there, guy? Right here? Okay. Let's just go... Symmetry on? No, it's good. Symmetry's not on. Okay. Put a tank on here for now. People can figure out that they have to, they can then route it wherever they want it. So diesel, there we go. All right. And 6, let's turn the volume up. I had the volume down. I was working on one of my helicopters, which is loud as hell today. So. All right, up and running. Can you guys hear that all right? Up and running. Let's press WS or W, get this engine revving. So everything's working. Auto clutch works. As you can see, we just have a 1-to-1 gear ratio. All right, good. So it is hooked and running. Let's bring this sucker back. All right, so that's up and running. All right, so that is good. Let's get the last couple things I need on the engine panel. So, for those who just start watching or whatever, what I'm trying to do here is make an engine transmission. I'm trying to make them two modules where you can then build on top of it and use it for your own cars. Some people asked for that. There'll be a panel node here if you want to add your own. For example, put your starter on a panel. You can do that and change things around. But for right now, it's going to be simple there. I think we're good. Alternator, clutch, battery. So that's battery recharge. We're good on that. Everything's working there. All right. So I think this panel is pretty clean and good. And so we can hopefully start working on the transmission. All right. So here comes the transmission panel. And I'm trying to think of the best way to run this. I'll regret doing it that way. Let's click this. Transmission. All right, and let's just do something like that for now. I'm just trying to see how it sits in the world. Okay, perfect. That actually turned the way I wanted it to. All right, beautiful. All right, so what we need here is we're gonna go logic. Try to decide, do I want to? No, I don't want to daisy chain this off the engine. Let's make it a separate panel. This way, if somebody already has their engine up and running, they can hook the transmission up separately. So that's what I'm trying to do, is I'm trying to make it so if somebody already has an engine, they just want the transmission, I can also release the transmission separately. And if you already have your engine, you just want a transmission, you can have the transmission separately. I think that's going to be the better way. So let's go composite input seat. I am not building an automatic. I don't care for automatics. Not going to do it. Maybe I'll do it again at some point. Don't really care for automatics. I'm going to make it manual. If you want to make it automatic, you do that. I might release an automatic later, but no promises on that. I really don't care for automatics at all. I find it the most boring way to operate a vehicle is to have it as an automatic. Up oh, property. All right, so property. If you notice on my property text, I'll put something called spawn. All that does is that tells me where the nodes are spawning. This is something I started doing. So, for example, that is where all my nodes are going to spawn. As I add more nodes, as you see, they're all stack up there. And then the first thing I do is I take these, I drag them, and I put them down here so that. Because often what will happen is you'll have all this microcontroller stuff in here and something will spawn right in the middle and you can't find it. By doing it this way, you'll have all your stuff down here, all your logic, and it spawns up there. It's a piece of cake to find. So I start to do that now. All right, let's go ahead and let's finish stuff here. So the seat's gonna do, I generally do my up down on my seat as my shift gears. And maybe I'll do an automatic, but we'll see at some point. So what do we need here? We have four gear boxes going into this transmission. Now, each of these gear boxes is like a gear set on a real transmission. So it'll be gear one, gear two, gear three, gear four. Okay, so that's one, two, three, four. Pretty simple there. Let's see, what else do I need? I don't think I need anything else there. I think that's good. Okay, so let's start working with this. As you can see, now they're up here, they're out of the way. All right, and these all need to be outputs. Output, output, out, and out. All right, it's good. So let's go ahead and go get these going here, and I'll stack these up. And so there are four gear outs. Okay, so let's get this going. So what we want to do is I'm going to make up down on the seat, which is going to be read number, and this is four. All right, so that is your up down axis. So what we need to do is then is I need to configure the seat. We need to go to up down. This is shift gear. It's going to be reset 100%. So really quickly, if you do this, what happens is when you press the up arrow, it's going to read a one. When you press the down arrow, it reads a negative one. When you let go of them, it reads a zero. So that turns it into essentially switches. And so you tap up, it gives you your up gear, tap down, gives you a down gear. You let go of it, does nothing. So that's what we want it to be doing. So let's go ahead in here. And what we need next is, so this is going to read one, negative one, or zero. So what we need is a couple threshold gates. And the first threshold gate's going to read one, one. This one's going to read negative one, negative one. All right, so each time we press this, we don't like, so if I press the up arrow and I hold it, I want one gear shift. That's it. I don't want multiples. So in order to get that, we're going to do a pulse, which a pulse is a toggle to push. That goes like that, and then this one goes like this. So that's going to make it so that even if I press and hold the up arrow, it's only going to give me one tick unless I let go of it and press it again. That's going to give me another one tick. So each tap gives me a gear. All right, good. So that's there. Next, we need an up-down counter. So we're counting by one, and we need to count our gears here. So we're going to go, this is going to be a simple, it's only a small car. It doesn't need, like my 18-speed transmission, which I released yesterday, has four reverse gears. You know why? Because the real one has four reverse gears. A 10-speed Eaton Fuller has two reverse gears. This is a regular car, truck, small truck. We don't need that. We have one. So we have one reverse gear. Zero is our neutral. And then we're going to have a max gear. We're probably, I want this like a 5 or a 6 speed. So let's do 5 to start with. We might change it. All right. So when we press up, we want this to count up. When we press down, we want this to count down. I generally don't do neutral on there. I have you walk through the gears. All right, so that is there. Okay, so here comes the transmission part. So next thing we need to do is I'll continue to set this up, and then what we'll do is we'll actually build out the transmission using my graph. So we have reverse, which is -1, -1. So when this number reads -1, it says, hey, man, I want reverse. Okay, then we start building forward gears. So we're expecting a 5 speed for now. We'll see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And these are all going to be forward. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so there are my 5. Forward gears and my 1 reverse gear. All right, so that's going to start like that. Next thing, I highly recommend booleans. And the reason is you can take this transmission panel. Let's say you want to make this an 18-speed transmission. You just copy these, move, put 18 more. If you do ORs, you might get in a situation where you run out of spaces. You're going to see some boolean blocks here. I'll use these 4s. I doubt we're going to need more than 4s. I think even in my 18-speed, I'll show you my 18-speed transmission. I'll show you what this transmission looks like in a complex tractor transmission. So we're going to need, just for our forward gears, actually one of these we don't even need. So we're going to need 3 of these to start with. And so all I do here is X. I'm actually going to delete these out for now. So this is pretty simple. So if we go into operators, here is the OR, this vertical line here. So we do X or Y or Z or W. So if I press any of these buttons, it will send out an on signal. That's all we do there. And we're actually going to need one fewer than these because one of these is my reverse. So all it's doing is it's going to read out reverse. So booleans, and all I'm going to plug these in is, I don't know which one I'm using as reverse. Likely, I don't know yet. So we're going to save that. So these booleans are all here. So that's where we end it for right now. We're going to update this, and then we need to figure out my gear ratios. So let's go ahead and save this. I'll save this as a backup. I always recommend saving a backup because if you accidentally screw something up, you can go to the backup. All right, let's look at the 18 and the 10-speed transmission. I released these last night. They're on the workshop. You can find them on Discord. If you don't have the Discord, go ahead and you can look in the description. You can find that. So here is the 10-speed. So, you know, people have said to me before, you know, I as a professional truck driver, you don't need 10 speeds in a truck. You do if you're hauling enough weight. And for example, you know, if you watch Courier Build Series, I haul 250,000 pounds of fuel with no problem with my trucks because I have a proper gearbox. And this is the 10-speed gearbox. So this only has 10 speeds. So as you can see, it counts. It has 2 reverse gears. That's why it's -2. And it has 10 forward gears. That's what this looks like to program the gears. This is all for the gear shifter. You don't have to worry about that. That's a 10. So you can see it looks pretty complicated. It's not too bad. One of the reasons it's complicated is these are all ORs. I should change these to booleans. Actually, at some point, I didn't know the release version didn't have booleans. But let's go ahead and let's look at the 18. The 18 should have everything switched to booleans. So that's what you saw, how complicated that looked because of all the ORs. This is much better having the booleans. You see how much more complicated this one is? And having the booleans, these ones, as you can see, are, was it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 8 nodes on there. And so that is what these look like to get all the configuration for the proper gear ratios in that. So we're not going crazy in this one. Let's go ahead. We'll bring it back up. And so what I'm actually doing is I'm bring up a couple examples of cars I have and trucks. And generally speaking, a lower gear means more torque. And so we'll talk about, I'll go into some of the theory. I talked before why I go into the theory is if you understand why something works, you understand why something's not working, and you can fix your own problem without pulling your hair out or getting frustrated. And so let's look at a gear, the gearboxes here. Let's see. So this is the gears here. So you see, pretty simple on a small car. And one of your gear ratios is going to have nothing attached. And the reason is all your gearboxes have either an off or an on position. One of your gears, all the gears are likely going to be in the off position. Yes, they do work in fuel tanks. I put them in there as a trick. And so one of yours is going to be in the off position. Everything's going to be in the off position because they're the standard gear. And so that's why that's like that. Or actually the four. This is a four speed that I left the five in there in case I want to change it, I think. All right, so this is a car, okay? So this car doesn't need, it's very light. Let's look at its mass. It weighs 770, and it doesn't tow anything. This car doesn't tow anything. It weighs 770, and it actually weighs as heavy as it did because I added a bunch of weight in there. So pretty light. It doesn't need a really insane transmission. Like you see, this is actually kind of my preferred transmission method is going aside. But I wanted to make this, the reason I went down on this one is I want you to be able to, kind of hide it a little bit better. I might go sideways on this. We'll have to see. So you notice this has no flywheel. I might make the one we have without a flywheel. I don't know. I tend to put flywheels in my trucks and I put no flywheel in my cars. But if we look here, we have the four gearboxes going in there. So let's go ahead and I will bring up this and we'll start working on the gear ratios. And I can kind of show you better in there than to actually just show you the gears. So let's stick with this. And I'm going to go ahead and grab my gear chart here. Take me just a second to get that up and running. All right, so I highly recommend this is the best way I found to get your gearing set up and to figure out all your gear ratios is to have a spreadsheet. So let's go ahead and bring that up. Where are we at here? Display, there it is. All right, so here is the gear chart. And so this is where a lot of people get confused. I'll try to explain it the best I can. First thing you need to understand about gearing is they are fractions. You multiply your fractions. You do not add your fractions. Keep that in mind. So you can see I have a bunch here. So we'll go to that car that I just looked at. So where is it here? I think it's the 7-speed. It's not a 7-speed anymore, though. I think it's like a... Let me see. Do I have my tow truck on here? Mining truck, rescue cart, mining overloader, vice car. So this is the vice car. This is what's most similar to that car I just showed you is the car for the vice. And so the first thing I highly recommend people do is it's simple math how gearing works. And if you go ahead and you look online at real car transmissions, they will tell you the gear ratios. If you know real gear ratios, it's going to make it so you don't have to try to figure all this stuff out on your own. You can just copy what or try to get close to what gear ratios they have. And so that's what I did here. So these are my desired gears. So I want a 3-to-1, a 2-to-1, a 1.5, a 1.16, and a 0.8. If it goes below 1, you're going higher. If it goes a higher number, you're going lower. And we'll talk about the theory of gearing really quickly in a second. But so that's what I wanted. And this is where I got 2.5, 1.66, 1.1, 0.83, and 0.55. And I actually went more towards this low number because I want to go faster in that car. F1 car, as you can see, is the similar. Let's see. I think I have a truck here. So mining overloader. This is a truck. All right. A big, heavy truck carrying a lot of coal, a lot of metal. This one needs a lower set of gears. And it needs to go slower in order. It doesn't necessarily need to go slower. But it needs a lower gear ratios in order to haul the weight, right? An object in motion wants to stay in motion. Object at rest wants to stay at rest. That object at rest, all that weight sitting on there, it wants to stay stationary, and it requires a lot of torque. So you need to down gear to get enough torque to move that heavy weight. That's why all my trucks start with a very low gear ratio. So if we look here, the Vice car, it starts with a 2.5:1 gear ratio. So 2.5 turns of the engine to move the wheel one rotation. The truck here that's very heavy, the engine moves 18 times to move the wheel once. Then it goes 15:1, 10:1, and a 5:1. Very low gear ratio on this. One of the reasons, the mining overloader, it never leaves the mine. I put it on a truck to go out of there because the truck is faster. That's what the truck is good at. The tractor trailer is good at driving on the road. The mining overloader is good in hauling a lot of weight in the mine itself. Here's a mini truck. I thought I had the tow truck. I don't know where I put the tow truck. I was trying to look for that, but okay. So here's the 18-speed transmission. You start at a 15 to a 12 to a 10 to an 8. To a 6, to a 5, to a 4, to a 3, to a 3, to a 3, to a 2, to a 2, to a 1-6, to a 1-3. So that you notice to a 1-2, to a 1-1, to a 0.83, to a 0.66. So as you can see, the reason you have all these gears in a truck, the reason why you have an 18-speed gearbox is you're only operating between, like in real life, between 1100 RPM and 1600 RPM. You have a very small window. That is your power band. And because of that, you need very small changes. So you see how small our changes are. You look at the cars down here. The car doesn't have a lot of mass to move. You can afford, because you're not trying to move a lot of mass, you don't need that much power. So it goes from a 2.5 to 1.6 to a 1.1 to an 8.3 to a 5.5 because you're not moving a lot of weight. You don't need those low gears. And so we're going to start by building one here. And so what I'll do is I'll try to explain the chart here. I'm going to go against my better judgment and rebuild it here. So here is the transmission tutorial. All right. And so we'll go ahead. We'll do transmission tutorial here. I'll color it something. All right. So here's the transmission tutorial one. Yeah, let me just get a color there. I colored the same color as the Vice car. Let's just do something else there. Okay. So here's the transmission tutorial. So let's actually rebuild this chart. It's kind of a pain, but I want to change some things so you guys can understand this a little bit better because people have been having problems understanding how this chart works. So for the most part, what we're going to do is, if you think of numerator is your top number on your fraction, denominator is your bottom number. You can also think of it as engine and wheels in this case. So my engine moves 10 times, my wheel moves 6. My engine moves 10 times, my wheel moves 9. My engine moves 10 times, my wheel moves 12. My engine moves 10 times, my wheel moves 18. And so that's the best way to think of that. So next thing, I'll actually just show you the formulas. It'll be simple. So the way you do your fractions is you multiply. You do not add your fractions, you multiply them. So a 2, if you put a 2-to-1 gearbox and then you put a 3-to-1 gearbox, it's 2 times 3 is 6, times 5 is 30, 1 times 1 is 1, times 6 is 6, so it would be 30 over 6. 30 divided by 6 is a 5-to-1 gear ratio. 2 times 3 is 6, times 5 is 30 over 9. 30 over 9 is 3.33:1. All right, and so that's all this is doing. It's multiplying my fractions for me, and then it is reducing them because I don't know what a 30 to 6 is, but I can better conceptualize a 5:1. All right, so that's all this is doing. So we'll just copy it. I won't bother rebuilding it. So let's go ahead and we'll copy this. And so I'll show you the formulas too. That will probably be helpful. So the formulas are pretty simple. If you look at here, it is this times this times this times this times this gives you this number. This times this times this times this times this gives you this number. This one here is this number divided by this number, and that is just a 1. So as you can see, that's just this one divided by this number. That just reduces your fraction for you. All right. So going in this, this is gear 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So that is counting through your gears as you shift. That's just counting through your gears. Pretty simple. I'm going to change all these to 1:1. And that's where we're currently at, 1:1. Now, I have it so it could have 5 gearboxes. Currently in the build we presently have, we only have 4. I leave that open in case I want to add one. Generally, for most cars, you're going to only need four boxes to get a plenty of variation in ratios. And so one of the places that I highly recommend is, so we'll go through step by step. So these are your six gears, one through six. We're probably not going to go all the way up to six gears. I'm shooting for a five. We'll see. Generally don't need it in game. And then what I'll do is I'll put, if you notice this one, it has these carrots. What this is doing is this is telling me which direction my gearbox is facing. So the one we put in there already, gear one is facing away, away, away. We only have four of them, and fourth is facing towards the engine. So that's away, away, away. And then I'll just put NA for not MA, NA for not applicable. There's no fifth gear in this right now. So this is just telling me which direction my gears are facing. So pretty simple there. All right, next thing we'll do, we'll quickly do a search for a pick a car. So we'll do Ford Mustang gear ratios. Pretty simple. They should come up here, and that's Pony Parts. That's this link up here. So let's see. I'm trying to see a good list of them. Generally, I look at truck stuff. I find that easier, but let's see. I'm trying to see where they are here. Manual, transmission, Mustang. Let's try to find something here. So Ford gear ratios. Okay, so usually finding a chart is going to give us the best one here. So here's, this is going to be our best here. So here we go. So this Ford actually has some really good charts that are easy. First gear is a 3.2 to 1. Second gear is a 1.95, a 1.32, a 1, a 1.13 for a fifth gear. Why is this one higher? Overdrive. And then most likely, potentially. Sixth gear is a 0.94. And then your reverse gear, often reverse is your lowest gear. We're not going to be able to do that because we have to run it through the same set of boxes. We're just reversing them, so don't do that. But as you can see, so these are what we're looking for. So we want about a 3.2. So what I'll do here is we'll go back. And over here, I tend to put in what I'm... So here I'll put desired gear. And so this is just kind of an outline. What gears am I looking for? So probably around here, I'm looking for a 3 to 1 is about what I'm looking for. And then about a 2 to 1, make it easier for myself. It doesn't need to be perfect anyway. And then here we have about a 1.3. So here's a 1.3 to 1. And then we have a 1.13. And here we have a 0.95 to 1. All right, so that's what I'm about what I'm looking for. Again, I highly recommend just go on there, look for that. For example, my favorite site for doing this is the Eaton Fuller site. If you go to Eaton Fuller, they do truck transmissions. And so when I start a truck, I go, and some of these have actually really driven IRL. So this one here, this light duty five or six speed, I have driven this one IRL. So I go to specifications. And where's my gear ratios? Pick one of the models here, I think. Resources. I've seen this before. I'm trying to find the chart. Let me see. That's the lubrication schedule. Where is the chart? Transmission. This is not what I'm looking for. Some of them pop right up, some of them don't here. So let's do like it should be in here, but they change it too. They want you to pay for stuff, or they want you to like sign in now so you can do it. But see if I find it here. Let's see. For example, let's go to the 18. The 18 had it before. They changed their website recently. They decided to be more obnoxious. So here's 9 to 13 speed manual transmissions. Often these had the specifications up. Let's see. Do you have them? So those are the model numbers. And then checking resources, see if they have them. But these will tell you what the truck Manuals and installation guides, product specification guides, tech data sheets. I don't want to download them. Anyway, so that will tell you the gear ratios for those. That's how I get all the gear ratios and how I can get them close. But now we kind of know where we want to be. We want to be at a 3-to-1, a 2-to-1, a 1-3, a 1 and there. So that tells us about where we want to be. And so let's start working. So gear 1, I tend to make my lowest gear. I tend to go lower to higher. Just kind of keeps it, you know, similar. So 3-to-1, done. 3-to-1, we want. We have a 3-to-1's done. All right, 2-to-1. Hey, that should be easy. 2-to-1, done. All right, 1.13. So now we need to start reducing. And so what we can start with is a 2-to-1 there. And one of our boxes is facing backwards. All right, so 4 is facing backwards. We can use this as a reduction gear when we want to reduce. So what we can start doing is we start playing with this. Because this is going backwards, we need to put the fraction upside down. All right. So the first value we have in that box is a 6.5. So we have put the one facing towards the engine is backwards. And the way we can tell that, again, is you need to consider this is how many times does the engine turn? So, for example, this we change numerator to engine, change denominator to wheel. All right. And so the engine is going to turn 2 times, the wheel is going to turn once. This one, the engine is going to turn 5 times, the engine is going to turn 6 times. And so notice it will be a 2 times 5 is 10 divided by 6 gives us a 1.66. That's not low enough, right? We want a 1.3. So what do? We go to the next value, 2, 3. 1.33, and we're done. That one is in there. Now we have to remember, these only give us 2 values each. So we have to keep that in mind. All right, next is 1.13. So we're already using a 1 here. All right. And so we can do a couple things. One, I think a 3-to-1 is going to be probably lower than we need. What we could do is we could make this a 6.5. And as you can see, that's still reasonably close. Not as high as I would like it, but that doesn't look too bad. Let's try something here. Let's try a... That's a 5-to-1. Let's reduce this by a bunch. That's a 2-to-1. Okay, let's do less. So 2.5, 2.4 there, and then probably not gonna want to do this. Nah, let's not do that. Let's go back the way we had it. So let's do 1-1s. So I know I'm gonna confuse people with this. So let's stick with where we're at here. So let's go. This box I'll keep easy. Again, a truck one, you really have to get into this with an 18-speed transmission, but with a car, let's keep it simple. 3-to-1, 2-to-1, 1.33 is close enough. The next one, we have to get lower here. So 2-1 is as low as I can go. A 1.13 is pretty close to 1, right? So why bother trying to get that 0.13 if we don't need to? Leave it. All right, now the next one here is we want to go below 1. So what do? We leave all these as 1s. And then for fourth gear, remember, we can go down to a 2.3 here. So let's try that. 2.3.66. That's probably a little on the low side, but I know in game that should run all right. All right, and we actually could probably, I might be able to cut the gearboxes down on this one. Probably not, actually. We'll be fine. So right here, 3 is going to be my reverse gear. So what I like to do is, once I figured out my reverse gear, I put that in there, it's going to be 3. So 3 is going to be my reverse gear. 4 is going to be my higher range gear. And so this one needs to stay 1-1. So what we can actually do with this is, I like to do it this way, and I'll tell you why. Because we have a reverse gear, right? We only have 2 gear ratios in game. We can have off and on. Off is currently 1-1s. When I go in reverse, I need to then go on, and I need to trigger gear 3 to be able to get my reverse gear, all right? Now notice which way this arrow is pointing on gear 3. Gear 3 is pointing away from the engine. Gear 4 is pointing toward the engine. So we can actually get these numbers even more finely tuned if we wanted them. We use gear 3 and we use gear 4. These two are setting the majority of our ratio, and then these are fine tuning. So let's say we wanted to fix this. Okay, so let's say we wanted to go, we have what we want here. Let's see if I can get these. This one fixed here. So this one here is a 1-to-1, and I want it about a 1.13, right? So let's fix it with gear 3. So let's try A 6-5. So we can only pick one ratio on this one because we have reverse. So that put that up by a 0.6. So we have to do this all the way through. But as you can see, I can step this up all the way through. Let's do 6-5 on this one, and I'll show you the trick on this. All right, so that stepped everything up. It made it lower. So if, let's say the car is stalling, let's say I actually want to do a pickup truck now, I could quickly change my car to a pickup truck by just changing gear 3, by making it lower, lower, lower. It changes all my ratios. Let's say I want to go make more of a car. I start changing 4 and I make it higher, higher, higher. And so currently right now we have a 3-6. Well, guess what? Let's not run a 1-1 on 4. Let's run a 6-5. So we can actually get rid of this if we did, nope, I'm sorry, 5-6 rather, there we go. See, that this cancels out this one. So if we wanted, we could use that as a canceling gear. And so right there, we get a 1.6, we can keep that. 2.4, I want it as a 2, so we'll cancel it. There's 2.88, let's see, do I want to do that? Probably not, let's see. I put it in backwards again. I know I did. Okay. That's a 2-1. Again, remember, this one's facing the opposite direction. We need to think of it as engine, wheels. That cancels that gear. So this one here, we want to get a little bit lower. So we can actually play with this just a hair. So right there, it's a 2-3. Let's try to get this a little bit... I'm sorry. We want this to be higher. Let's try to get a little bit higher. So what's the next one? A 9-5, I think. There we go, 1.33. And then this one here, we're at a 1.2. We want to get this a little bit higher. So let's go. We could either do a 5-6, which gives us a 1-1, or we could do the 5-9, which gives us a 0.66. So let's do the 5-6. That gives us a 1. That's close. And then this one is currently at a 0.8. We want it at a 0.95. So we can do 5-9, which gives us a 0.66, or we could do a 5-6, which gives us a 1. So we want to do the 5-9 there. And I think this is looking pretty good. This might be a little bit of a jump here, but it's not too bad. I know this usually works, so I think it'll be pretty good. So we're going to make this a 5-speed. And if we look at our gears, so this part always confuses everybody. It's kind of a pain, but... essentially, all we're doing is we're multiplying our fractions through, and this one we have to. This one always we have to put in all the gears, and the reason we do that is again we're using the other gear ratio is reverse. And then this one currently I'm using two gear ratios, 5-6 or a 5-9 to get those out. So those are my two options. I can also go back and change these if I need to, but as you can see, we're running pretty well. We're close. 3-1's right on the money. 2-1's right on the money. 1-3 is right on the money. This one's a little bit off, but not by much. It's only off by 0.13. And then this one's pretty low, or pretty, I can say it's pretty low. The number is small, but the gear is going higher. It's going into a higher gear. And let's talk about the kind of theory of gearing really quickly. Just, I think it will help some people out. So to understand why gears work, there was GM used to put out some really cool, like old school videos of how this stuff would work, IRL, and it was really neat. And so when you're going, if you think about some physics stuff here, go to 10. Let's go red here. All right, so think about a wrench, right? You have a wrench. And if you have a really short, dinky little handle in the wrench, this is where your hand goes, right? So we'll say H for hand, right? And then over here you have your nut. Right, so you have your wrench, and your wrench is only this long, right? And so your wrench is very short. You don't have much torque. So the longer the arm, right, the greater the torque. So if you want more torque, what do? You increase the length of your wrench. Now you have a really long wrench. You have a lot of torque, okay? So now imagine you are turning your wheel with this wrench. If you put your hand on this end of the wrench and you have your wheel right here, right, you go to turn the handle and you move your wheel a little bit, right? And with a short handle, you're not going to be able to move much weight because you don't have a lot of torque. Now, hook this to the end of your wheel and hook your hand here and push down. Now you can move a lot of weight because you have a lot of torque, all right? So now, go ahead and take a circle. All right, and now start putting some more wrenches, right? Because you don't want to have to, like, move your arm and grab the other side of this, right? You say, okay, I'm going to be moving this car with my arm. So I want to have a bunch of these that I can grab onto. So I put one here, and 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 I push this one down with my hand, then I grab this one, I pull this one, and yay, I'm turning, right? I'm able to turn this wheel, right? Let's say I want more handholds. So I keep adding handholds onto this, right? I want even more handholds. I keep adding handholds to my wheel. I keep adding more handholds to my wheel. And eventually, it starts looking like a gear. And that's why gears look like they are. All a gear is many levers that are attached to a central pivot. And then instead of your hand, you have another gear that meshes in here. So the other gear comes in and it meshes. The same physics applies. The longer your lever, the more torque. So if you were to look at gears, right, a small gear, so we're just going to use circles here. So a small gear, it can move fast, right, because it doesn't have a lot of distance to cover. But it doesn't have a lot of torque. And then you have a large gear, which has a lot of torque. There's a big distance from the center to the outside that gives you more torque. So in a real gearbox, your lower gear ratios, your higher torque gears are bigger and have a larger diameter. Your higher speed gears are smaller and have a smaller diameter. Again, let's say whatever you hook up to this, right? This is where the engine's turning, right? If I have my engine gear touching a large gear, this one's going to turn, say, 10 rotations for every one rotation this turns. That sounds familiar, right? That's putting in high torque, low gear ranges. Now, let's say you take your car, and that's turning that's a shaft from the engine, and then you put another equidistant gear there. Well, guess what? That's a 1-to-1 gear ratio. For every one rotation of this, you get one rotation of this. So this would be a 10-to-1 gear ratio. This would be a 1-to-1. So that's all you're really doing in a real transmission and what you're doing in the transmission in game. So these numbers start to make a little bit more sense now. This one here, the engine's turning 3 times for every one time the wheel is turning. Well, that means that the gear from the engine is 1/3 the size of the gear that turns the output shaft for the wheel. This one is, double the size. That one's only 1.13, and then this one's actually smaller, so the engine is turning fewer times than the wheel is turning, all right? So we have our gear ratios kind of figured out here. This is what we're going to shoot for. Now we need to make this work, all right? We need to make this work in game. So let me try to see if I can't... trying to get these to overlay properly. Wish me luck on that. All right, so here we go. So we have our gear ratios. And first thing I want to do is I want to look at them. So what is the most common gear here? One to one happens 4 times. 3 to one only happens once. All right, so pretty simple there. So we're going to go in and we're going to click on the first gear. And we're going to make 1 to one our default position. We're going to make 3 to one our secondary position. All right. And I find this every time. All right, so the next one here. 2 to 1 only happens twice. The rest are 1 to 1. So it's going to be 1 to 1, and then it's going to be 2 to 1. So we click on our next one, 1 to 1, 2 to 1. All right, and we'll go back. And we look. And so remember, third is our reverse gear. So it needs to be 6-5 is always on, and we trigger reverse. So it doesn't always have to be third gear. I tend to like to have it as third gear. So 6-5, 1-1. All right. That's our reverse gear. Next one here, we have, we're only doing 4 gears. So that's why this one's all 1-1. It's going to be 5-9, 5-6, 5-6, 5-9, 5-6, 5-9. So it's 1-2-3-5-6 is 2-5-9s. Okay. So this one here, and all that's doing really is canceling. So 3-5-6s, and then this is a 9-5. All right, so now we have these set up with the correct gear ratios they all need. All right, so now we need to go in the box, and we need to set up the box, the microcontroller. So let's go in here, And let's set up all these. So what we need to do is we need to find when do we trigger those gears. All right. So this one's pretty simple, right? Third gear is our reverse gear. So what we do is we'll grab third and we'll stick it up here. And the only time we trigger third is when we go in reverse. So that one's done. All right. So I'll go ahead and I'll bring up my chart again. So now we need to look at this and we need to count these out. So gear one, we need to figure out when do we trigger gear one. We only trigger gear one in first gear. So here's first gear. We trigger gear one just then. All right. So for first gear, we're going to trigger this first gear here. All right. So that only gets triggered once. But I also want my reverse to be, I want my reverse to be the same low gear as first gear. And the reason is pretty simple, right? When you're stopped, you need a lot of energy to get your car moving. And so in first gear, we need a nice low 3-to-1 gear ratio to get the car moving. We also need that nice low 3-to-1 gear ratio to get it moving in backwards because we stopped the car. The car is heavy. It doesn't want to move. And so we need to push it backwards. So our reverse gear is going to be a 3-to-1 as well. So first is 3-to-1 and reverse is 3-to-1. Both of those are the same. And this one is just a touching 2 because we just need to reverse it. All right. And then let's go ahead and grab this back up. All right. So that one's easy. Now, this one, we trigger 2-to-1 on gears 2 and 3. The rest, it stays there. So gears 2 and gear 3, we trigger gear 2. All right, done. All right, next we need to go in and we need to find out 3 is done. So we're up to 4 now. So 4 is going to be, so 5, 6 is a default position. So that's the one that's in the off position because that comes up 3 times. Here, here, and here. 5-9 comes up on 3, and 5-9 comes up on 5. So 3 and 5 for gear 4. So, I'm sorry, where are we at? 3 and 5. This one comes up for gear 4. Now, I said before, one of these is going to be nothing. And the reason it's nothing is because this is the default position. This is all of them in their default position, and we can even look at that on the chart. If we look at the chart and we look at gear 4, 1-to-1, 1-to-1, 6-5, that's the default position, and then 6-5, that's the default position. This one, we don't need to trigger any gears. That is the default position with nothing triggered, is 4. That's why it's missing. I leave this here because guess what? You change your gear ratios, you may want to hook it. So I leave that in case I need to change my gear ratios. We'll hook up 4. All right, so now what this is going to do is when we press our up arrow to go from neutral to first gear, it's going to kick this gear into a 3-to-1 gear ratio, giving us a 3-to-1. Let me just double check. Nope, I screwed something up here. Let me check something. Nope, it's fine. The default position on my gears 3 and 4 are to cancel each other out. So that's fine. So when we press the up arrow to get into first gear, it's going to trigger us into a 3-to-1 gear ratio. When I press it up into 2, it's going to trigger us to go to a 2-to-1 gear ratio. When I go into third, it's going to trigger both of these to get us into that ratio. Fourth is all the default positions, and 5 is going to trigger this one to switch us into our highest ratio. All right, so that is all set now. Let's double check it. We're good. Okay, let's update. Let's hook in the seat, and let's start plugging in boxes. So we have gear 1, we have gear 2, we have gear 3, and we have gear 4. All right, so those are all plugged in. Let's check electricity. Those are all plugged in. We need electricity to be able to shift our gears. And I think we should be good. Let me see. Did I hook up the alternator? I think I did. Okay, so I think everything's hooked up. Let's go ahead and I really didn't want to have to do it, but I'm going to hook up steering just so that we can drive around a little bit and I can show you guys. So this is my trick for this is I'm going to cut this. Doesn't work if I put it in a stability system, but you can go like this and that just reverses the direction of the wheel. When I put in a stability system, I need that wheel facing the right direction because I have to reverse something anyway. And then we're going to do AD for steering. And it should be the bottom one of this one. All right, so now we have our steerings connected and I can just drive around. I do. I have a steering controller. I'll put that on the workshop. Yeah, if you guys want stuff like that, just let me know because I can then, I have them. I just need to put them out. I'll actually show you that too. All right, so let's start up. All right, so this is up and running. Let's check our steering. Okay, so we're in neutral. I'm going to press down the W key. Nothing. Nope. Why are you moving? Let me see. What's up with this? Oh, I didn't put a clutch zero in there. Okay, so this is what I need to do. Ooh, this could be a pain here. So I need to put a clutch zero in. It's gonna start me in fourth gear. This is the issue. This is the problem with the boxes not talking to each other. So I need to make these boxes talk to each other. So generally I put them in one box, but I didn't on this on purpose. So let's see, seat. RPS, clutch, battery, air manifold, alternator, starter. Let me see how I want to do this. Okay, this actually isn't too bad because the seat can talk through. So let's go. Let's do this. I'm trying to think of the best way to do this. I need an out on this. So let's take panel. I'm not using panel right now. Let's just change this to transmission. Okay. So I'll go out to transmission. Go in this box here, and we need to go. And that will go like that. That's not going to work. I'm trying to think of the best way to do this. I need a read in as well, so. All right, I'm just going to do this. All right, let's do that. Not ideal, but I kind of have to. All right, so this is going to come in here. And I need to report the gear ratios. So let's go in here. Okay, this box has plenty of space here. So let's do this. Shrink this up a little bit here. I didn't mean to do that. All right, let's go composite output to engine panel. I don't like making an enormous panel because it's super hard in cars to hide them. I'd rather make a couple smaller panels. So two engine panel right here is just going to read out. We'll read out this here. So we'll read out this value. We'll write the number, and I'm just going to make a high number just to get it out of the way. Crap, didn't mean that. Just make it 25 for now just to get it out of the way. All right, so what this is going to do here is this is going to read out to the engine panel, and then seat can actually go like this. And what we can do is this, update that. And from transmission, we'll now go, I won't screw with that yet. But anyways, we'll take this, and what we need to do is the clutch will be zeroed. Grab Boolean. And we'll take this Boolean. We're just going to do the same thing we did before, X or Y or Z or W. And this will connect here. So this is for when do we neutralize our clutch, when do we put our clutch in. So that will be these, and then the last condition is going to be if we're in neutral, we want that clutch to be pushed in. So what we'll do here is I could duplicate it, but I'd rather not. Could duplicate the counter is what I was thinking. So what we need here is from transmission, and what did I say, 29? Is anyone paying attention? Did I say 25? I can't remember what number I put. Was it 25 or 29? 25. That goes there. Oh, wrong number. 25. All right, so this is going to just neutralize the clutch when the clutch readout is 0. 25. Okay, good. Yeah, so when it's 25 from the transmission, that's going to read that out to us. Let me just check the panels, make sure I put it in there right. 25 going out to engine panel. Okay, update. And then this is going to be good. Yep. Okay. So that's going to make it so that, because what it's trying to do is trying to move in fourth gear if I'm in neutral. And if I'm in neutral, it should not be moving. And so this is going to go to engine panel from transmission. And I actually don't need that one. That's fine. So that can be panel. So that works better that way anyway. All right. So let's do it. that's why we're moving. Generally, a lot of my builds, I'll make them the same panel, and that's why I forget to do that. All right, so I'm holding. Why are we moving again? What the hell is going on here? I didn't do the threshold gate on the transmission, that's why. Okay, I know what I screwed up here. That's fine. Let's do it this way instead. Let's do it, if this is threshold gate, if this is zero, I have to convert it in one of the panels. I'll just convert it here. All right, and then we'll write it as on off instead. That'll work. All right. So that'll work. That was what was screwed up there. So this will zero the clutch out when we're in neutral. So this will allow us to rev up. So this is actually helpful. For example, I'll tell you in a second. Like, say we're building a fire truck and we want to have a PTO where you will spin up your engine to turn an impeller pump to pump water. You could put it in neutral, rev up, hold it in neutral. All right. So see, I can rev it neutral, nothing happens. All right, let's look at everything. So now I took my foot off the clutch, right? We have zero clutch pressure. So that is gonna allow me to coast better. Engine braking's a thing, IRL, but I don't really need it all that much in game. It has low applicability. I'd rather have it just float the clutch. And so let's go ahead and we'll shift into first gear. So we're in first gear. A nice low 3-to-1 gear ratio. Alright. Now I'm gonna rev it all the way. Now if my transmission would, or my engine is set to go, let's see. I can't see the actual speed. I can't see the speed of it. I can't see, oh, RPS right in front of me. So okay, so see, I set my RPM maximum to 25, or 20 rather. We're going 19, okay? Now, I can tell my speed, or I can tell the rotations of the wheel. Remember, it's a 3-to-1, so it should be 1/3 of that, all right? So our wheels will be turning 1/3 of that. If I know the diameter of my wheel, say my wheel was 0.5 meter, and I know we're moving, you know, 1/3 of that, you know, I can do that math, and I can actually figure out my speed from this. All right, so next it's going to be a 2-to-1. Notice my wheels, they spun up once, but notice, we don't have squealing wheels. A lot of people, the reason you have squealing wheels in game constantly is because in game, the wheels will spin up if your gear ratio is too low or too high. In real life, if your gear ratio is too high, you will stall. You will not spin your tires. In game, it will allow us to spin the wheel to make it a little bit more user-friendly, would be my guess. All right, let's go up our next gear. What is it, a 1.33? There's a 1.33. No, notice, no wheel spinning because I have a proper gear ratio. That is what most people's problem is when they spin going straight, is they're either over-torquing their wheels, so they're breaking traction, or they're under-geared, and they are spinning their wheels constantly. And we're up to our top gear here, fifth. If I keep pressing up, I guess we're in fourth. Now we're in fifth. Downshift. I don't think downshift's working. I need to look at why downshift's not working. All right. Let me look downshift. That's not working. I'll put a couple dials on here so you guys can tell what's going on here. All right, so that is giving us our gear ratio. Let's do a linear speed. I'll do a couple things, just kind of showing you some theory here and why things work the way they do. Let's see, where are you at here, guy? Stick this here. I just need this somewhere where I can reach it because I'm not going to put a dial. I'm just going to have that sitting there. I can still see this. That is there. Why is my seat not counting down? Up, down, shift gear, reset, 100%. Okay, transmission. Where are you at, transmission? All right, where's my counter here? So that is counting at 1, reset value 0. That's fine, we don't want that. 1.5, that's all good. Is that enabled? That's enabled. Push toggle. Oh, this is why. I didn't plug that in. So that's why I couldn't downshift, was that wasn't plugged in. All right, So let's go ahead and we'll look at the linear speed sensor. Now we should be able to figure our speed out, right? So we actually can figure out the diameter of our tire. That's kind of cool. So let's go rev it up in neutral. All right. So we're getting about 19. If we look, it's 19.3. So remember how I told you with that nice low p-value, it doesn't give me a lot of oscillation, but we'll never reach 20. That's fine. You know, we're within 0.5 of 20. We don't need that much accuracy. We really don't. All right. So there is 19 RPS. And so if we do a third of 19, so let's do 19.5 divided by 0.33 equals... nope, that's wrong. Is it 19? That would be 0.33 divided by 19.5 equals... Nope, what the hell am I doing here? What is one third? okay, that's why. It would be 3.3. 19.5 divided by 3.3 equals... So we should expect that our wheel is turning at 5.9 RPS. So the wheel is turning 5.9 times in first gear. Click it in first, and let's test it out. All right, so now I can't tell the rotation of my wheel. Actually, I can. So we're pretty close there. 5.9 is what I did quick back of the envelope math. We're a little bit higher there. So there we go. And now let's look at our speed. We're going 13.8 meters per second. So we're doing about 26 miles an hour in, or knots, miles an hour is close. A little bit more in miles an hour in first gear. Switch to second. Our speed should have gone up. As you can see, we're going 20. Knock it up again. 29. There's about 60 miles an hour, a little bit more than 60 miles an hour, 65. And that's about a little bit better than 80 miles an hour there. And there is over 100 miles an hour. So pretty good for a car. So we're able to go from zero up. And you notice no stalling because, hey, how's it going, Diablo? Because we don't have a lot of mass here. There's very low mass in this car. All right. So this car is working well. The gear ratios. So what did I do? I took real-life car gear ratios, and they work. You know, and the math is simple. And that's why it works, is the math is simple. Now, if I pack a bunch of weight on here, I would need truck gear ratios. So I would want to lean more towards like that medium Eaton Fuller transmission I was trying to show you guys that wouldn't show me the sight. It's about a 7-to-1 is the first gear ratio. So the car is a 3-to-1 to start, and it's going down to a 0.66. The truck would be more like a 7 down to about a 1. The 6-speed Eaton Fuller will go down to, I think, a 0.89. The 5-speed goes down to a 1. And so that's your simple transmission there with four boxes. You can do some stuff if you want to tighten up the space. You probably saw like my car. I had a little bit of space. I put the transmission on the side. You can do that. You can put it parallel to your drive shaft. Trying to keep this as compact as possible. Trying to keep these panels compact. Let's work up the last couple panels, and I should be able to hopefully release this. I have to wrap it up. But all right, so we're in the wrong box here. So let's go here. And I want to clean this one up and fix everything. So we need a couple nodes here. Let's see. Starters, fine. Transmission. So I have an option. I'm trying to think if I want to do this. Let's do this. I'm probably going to regret it, but I'm trying to keep these panels as compact as possible because, like I said, it's hard to fit these things on a car effectively. So let's do this. Where are we at here? Where is the from transmission panel? From transmission. So this is going to come over here now. Okay, so there's another thing I want to do. Let's do this before I redo the whole panel. So there's another condition when I want to zero the clutch. I want to zero the clutch when we shift gears, all right? And so I'm trying to think of what we're doing there. So I'll do that after I convert some of this over. So what I'm going to do is get rid of seat, and I'm just trying to make these more compact. And so let's go like this, go there and there. Okay, that's all from the transmission panel. And hopefully this doesn't confuse people, but what I'm doing is I'm trying to get these panels smaller. So what we'll do is we'll update that. The transmission already has the seat going in. And that's right here. And so what we'll do is we'll read out seat to this one here. And now all my seat is going to run through that panel. So we'll hook the seat up to the transmission. That will go through there. And the reason is I need to add a couple things in this box, and I don't want this box to be too big. And so from transmission to transmission, we need both those. Then seat can be changed to something else. So let's see. Where's seat? Seat's all the way up top. Seat is going to be now going to be an on-off output radiator. And then I need one more node here. And I'm just doing this to try to save some space and not have duplicates. This is going to be an output. This is going to be pump clutch. All right, pump clutch. And I didn't do the alternator yet, so we'll do that before I end. All right, radiator there, and then pump clutch is right here. All right, so 3 is our temperature. So we're going to set up our radiator. So what I do is pretty simple. If my temperature is greater than 100 degrees, and so what we'll actually do is we'll do property. So we'll do a property number right here. And this way you can configure it how you want. And this will be the cooling min temp. And so this will set what the minimum temperature you want. So your engine will ignite at 120. This will not turn on your radiator until 100. This is what I usually do. If you have a problem with it still overheating, I would not recommend lowering this number. What I'd recommend is putting in more cooling. And we're going to test the cooling. I want to make sure all this runs before I release it to you guys. I'm trying to get, you know, good practice with that. So when it's over 100, the radiator will turn on. All right. And what I'm going to do is I want maximum pumpage. So what I will do is I'm just going to do this. So there's a couple ways to do this. One, I could put in another PID. Let's do that. I don't know. I don't think it's going to have, this does, the pump clutch does not have a lot of drag in the engine. So there's two ways you could do this. One, put in another PID. All right. And what the PID will do is will automatically change how fast the pump turns to give you the exact amount of water flow you need in order to keep your engine at exactly 100%. That is overkill. I don't need to do that. That is just going to cause, that could possibly cause problems. What is better and an easier solution is do numerical switch box. When we're below 100 degrees, there's going to be no pump clutch. When we go over 100 degrees, it's going to give us 100% pump clutch. So it's now turned that pump into an on-off switch. If we go over 100 degrees, radiator and pump is going to come on. And likely what's going to happen is it's going to knock us below 100 degrees. They're both going to shut off, radiator and pump. We're then going to go above 100 degrees. It's going to kick the cooling back on. So it's essentially a cooling on-off switch. It is not super elegant, but it works, and it is low complexity. It is, you don't have to tune the p-value. You don't have to play with the p-value. You don't have to screw around with it. And so that's why I'm going to make this for myself. I tend to do that for other people. I'll make it a little bit less of a pain in the ass, essentially. So let's do that, update that. And so we need to check some stuff. I want to make sure my radiator operates properly. Thanks, Danny. Glad you find it helpful. Let's do pump clutch. So that's going to go here. And let's see. Where is my radiator? Radiator right here. That plugs into the electric radiator. All right. And let's see if we can't test all that out. So one thing we need to check out, water flow. If you have unstable water flow, you are not cooling at all. And if you have unstable water flow, you're not cooling at all. There's no point. I did a fix your build earlier in the week. I fixed somebody's tank. They had no flow rate. That means you have no cooling. Your water's not moving. You're not cooling. So let's check the radiator. Notice we have this oscillation. That means we have no cooling. All right. And the reason likely is there are very small chances you do need to add a tank of water. If you have a very small engine, you sometimes need to add a tank of water. So, as you can see, I didn't put a cooling manifold. That would be why. I didn't put a cooling manifold. All right, so that would be why we're having problems here. Let's see. Let me see. I need to figure out how to loop this. I didn't put a cooling manifold yet, so that would be why I jumped the gun on that. Let's put this in there. I can't put it there. All right, let's just do this. Cut you, back you up. All right, let's go ahead and... where do I want to put this? So I need to put a cooling loop. I just had yet to get the cooling and forgot to put the manifold in. So that goes in there, and then... so this may not need water now, because this is their cooling manifold is what gives you access to the water. So we'll see. All right, so that's plugged in now. Merge you. All right, so now that's hooked in. Let's try to get this up over 100 degrees. And I need to test the flow rate. I'm going to take a quick bathroom break while this is heating. All right, I turned the sound down. So see, I just used my trim. I have my W pressed all the way up. That's just going to floor it in neutral. All right, and watch the temp rise, and I will be right back. I'm just going to use the bathroom. All right, so this is not gonna probably want to heat up very quickly because we have no load on it. So let's... okay, so see what I just did there? That would be a disaster in real life. All I did was I pressed the up arrow. Notice how we didn't stall. Notice how I didn't have any explosions. Notice how my clutch didn't smoke and die like it would in real life. In real life, you'd wear your clutch out if you just threw it in gear. I can do that in game because I have that auto clutch. The auto clutch will automatically feather the clutch in. It had a huge amount of torque. We're stuck at 20 RPS here, and it put it right in gear, no problem, because the auto clutch gave it as much clutch as it needed to operate properly. So don't have to worry about that. All right, so we shouldn't have any cooling at all yet because we're still at 28. The problem is I'm trying to load this engine up to get us heating, but I have very often run many of my ground vehicles with no cooling. As you can see, this thing has been revving at max revs the entire time. We'll run out of fuel before I ever heat this up. So let's go ahead and test it, but I doubt we're going to have any cooling problems. As you see, we've gone from, 20 to 30, and I've been at red line the entire time. And, you know, it's going to take us forever to get this. We'll run out of fuel before I'll ever get that to overheat. So let's try something here. I just want to check the flow rate. So flow rates need to be working. So what we'll do here is we'll quickly click on our engine. If we go down here to cooling temp, minimum temp, let's just change that to zero. And that will turn on the clutch and the radiator right away. See, they're on. And if we look at the clutch, did I plug it in? I hope I plugged it in. We have a clutch pressure of 1, so I need to start the engine. All right, all we want here is, I want those numbers to stop oscillating. So notice the numbers stop oscillating, so we're good. There are more effective ways to cool, but as you can see, this is very compact. This is going to be fine. As you saw, it is likely going to take a very, very long time for this to overheat, if at all. And so as long as these fluid numbers are stable, you notice they're not moving at all, that means you have good cooling. If they're oscillating like they did at the beginning and they stayed oscillating, you have no cooling. So cooling should work fine. I'm not going to test it all the way up to 100, but that should work fine. All right, I'll show you another thing. We'll put an automatic kill switch in here. So I'll show you a couple things. People are finding some of this helpful. So let's go in here and back to a minimum cooling temperature, 100. The engine will run best at around 100. It's kind of based off real life. Real life, you want to get up to operational temperatures. You start to, you know, in real life, you're lowering the viscosity of your oil. You're increasing the temperature of all your grease. They're flowing better. Your pumps are now moving a less viscous fluid through your lubrication pumps, and so therefore you're dropping the load on the engine. All right, so that is up and running. Let's go ahead and check some other things. I'm not going to put in brakes or anything. I will make a chassis. All right, the chassis will have wheels and brakes and all that set up. That's going to be something different. This is just going to be engine and transmission. All right, let's see. What else do I need to do? I just thought of what I needed to do, and I forgot. Alternator. There's something else, too. I'll have to figure it out. Let's see. Did I put an alternator? Clutch, fuel manifold, air manifold. Alternator right there. Okay, I just didn't do it yet. All right, let's do the alternator. I'm just going to copy this PID. Oh, no, it is right here. Okay, alternator is set to, I don't know, I didn't even bother with the p-value, but let's quickly check it and see what we're doing for electricity. So let's grab this. Let's just grab the best thing to test it is a motor. Motors eat up battery like it's going out of style. And so I'm just going to go like this. And you need to put load on these to actually make them work and actually use some electricity. So I'm just going to take a constant number. And so this is just, I'm just going to drain the battery, make sure we're recharging. Again, I want to release this in the workshop, so I don't want this to be, I want to make sure this works. So this is going to just drain a bunch of electricity. The PID on the alternator should adjust the belt tension or the clutch on the alternator, which is what you really have. You have an electromagnetic clutch, and that the power comes on, it drags the clutch plates towards the magnet, it then causes the belt to turn, and you start charging electricity. When you have enough, it will reduce. And so let's go ahead and we'll spawn this. I'll rev it up, and then, oh, I know, remind me, guys, see that turning? Okay, I want to put in a clutch blipper. Just remind me of that. All right, so let's check our battery. The battery, as you can see, is going down. Remember I said the electric motors use a ton of electricity. Let's check the alternator. All I want to see is, okay, so see clutch pressure is up around 4. One is the most. So it's doing its job. It is putting the clutch up as high as it can go. I could clamp that, but it doesn't matter, because the internal PID is still going to be reading 5. It's just not going to show me 5. It doesn't matter to me. So you notice that is up like that, using a ton of electricity. And the alternator is going crazy, trying to go really high to try to overcome that. It's never going to be able to overcome it. But we can take something like a light. And we can do the same test. And we'll just take a date off the seat for now, because I'll delete that in a second. So clutch blipper I need to do. All right, so the light is now draining electricity, right? Let's look at our battery. Notice we're building electricity. That number should start to slow down. Notice it's slowing down. The closer it gets to 1, the less clutch we're going to have in there. And if we look at our clutch on there, alternator 0, see it go up to 0.000019. That is the PID telling it how much clutch pressure it needs to charge the battery. Notice the battery is at 0.9999999. That's how much clutch pressure we need to maintain that battery at just under one. And that is only putting a tiny amount of load in the engine. We could just put a one in there. You'll see people do that. But I like doing this because it's only taking as much power away from our engine as I need to keep that battery topped off. That's it. So that's working. Now let's do blipper and then, sorry, I saw something in chat. I don't want to forget this blipper really quick. So all a blipper is, it's not really a blipper. It's what it's going to do is it's going to zero the clutch really quickly if we switch gears. So let me see. Let's put that there. Put this here. I probably shouldn't cover these up so that because people are going to see this in the workshop. Let them know where things are connected. What is this? Okay, that's there. All right. So what we can do here is from transmission. Let's see. Where is the one? Or the zero, rather. Okay, let's do this. So the seat is on here. So if the threshold... that's wrong. Where are we at here? Threshold right here. Okay. Threshold. And then what we want to read is we want to read channel 4. So we want to read channel 4. So channel 4 is going to report the seat. And then remember, we shift our gears with one or negative one. Actually, we could do this. Let's do not. Let's see how this does. So what this is going to do is this is going to like put the clutch in and get rid of clutch pressure when you're shifting gears. That way it won't slam it into gear. So if this is not zero, as in it's one or negative one, those are our three options. One, negative one, or zero. If it's not one of those, it's going to just quickly drop the clutch to zero, and then it will reapply the clutch. So as we shift gears, it's going to it's called unloading the engine. You're relieving the engine from the load of the wheels when you go to shift gears. So that's what that's going to do here. So that is what that is. All this does is it unloads the box. Like, this is how I do it if I was doing it, trying to keep straight lines, but I'm trying to make it so you guys can see what I'm doing. So that's what that is doing. So that will zero the clutch out when we shift, and we can actually test that. I'll show you. It'll behave a little bit better. It will just quickly zero out the clutch and have to reapply the clutch like you would in real life. Like, when I drive a tractor trailer, I don't use the clutch when I shift because I manually match the speed of the engines to the speed of the wheel. Now let's just... All right, let's shift into first. Second. So notice our wheels didn't spin up that time. That's because it zeroed the clutch. Wheels didn't spin up, zeroed the clutch. Wheels didn't spin up, zeroed the clutch. Wheels didn't spin up because it zeroed the clutch. Okay, the problem it's having now is it's feathering the clutch too much. Let me make sure it doesn't like, if I go through the gears too fast, it's not going to like to reapply them. Let's see what speed we're going here. 60. So see, it's dropping down. That's because it zeroed the clutch. Now it's slowly reapplying it. So we can go faster, but it's going to quickly drop our speed initially. See, it's dropping it. So that blipper is doing that, which I'm not thrilled with. Let's do this instead. We can do this a couple ways here. I might take the blipper off. I don't know. It's fine, but people are going to wonder why it's doing this, and so I might not want to blip it. What we could do is this instead. Let's just take an oar. We can switch it and do this instead. This will just... We can put it here instead, and instead of zeroing it, what it will do is it will just prevent it from adding more clutch. It's not as good of a blipper, but people might not know why it's doing that and think something's broken, so I have to kind of think of that if I want to release the workshop. All right, let's go. I mean, I'll have to check up in chat in a second here. Let's see how this blipper works. If this doesn't work as well, I might just leave it because I'd rather people want to put in their own blipper do it than have them confused why the blipper doesn't work. All right, this blipper is working better. So watch the speed now. It won't drop anymore. So that's smoother. So that's a better blipper. You can do it either way, but that one, you know, it takes a second for the clutch to come reapply. All right, let's test. I haven't tested reverse yet. So there's reverse. And it didn't like reverse because I slammed it in reverse. So I don't have brakes on this. That's the problem. All right, let's just take this back to workbench. I'll test reverse because I haven't tested reverse. And I'll catch up on chat. I think it's pretty much close to being ready to be released. So let me test reverse. Reverse. All right, now let me talk about some things you can change here. So, seeing that this is going to be going to be released the workshop, I have to clean it up. But so let's watch something. So let's spawn it. And I want you to see how quickly it will start to go forward. And this is something, again, why I would rather do a longer tutorial that you guys can understand the mechanics of it. And so let's start this up. And we'll go forward. And so I'll tell you when I press W and see how fast it applies the clutch. So W. All right, see how that's a little bit slow? All right. If you want faster clutch application, what you do is you come in here to your engine, go to your clutch, which is right here, and you change this value. So let's make it 5 times faster. So now this should apply that clutch 5 times faster than it was before. All right. And for a car that doesn't weigh much, that's fine. So let's do that. So we actually probably put the blipper back if the clutch application is correct, but this new blipper works fine. So now I'll tell you when we hit W again. W. So see how it's zippier? And it's right on the edge of stalling. So we probably don't want to get any faster than that. I'll run it through all the gears. So it's applying that clutch faster. That's why we're squealing tires for a little bit. But it's working. Yeah, we're going a little over 100 miles an hour here. So we're going, about 120. It's about 120 miles an hour, somewhere in that neighborhood. So get good speeds out of this. You actually go faster with a little bit more weight because you get more traction on the tires. But so this is up and running. So this is, I think we're pretty good on this. Let me check the panels one more time. I think everything's set up. I like that new clutch better. Let's see where we're at here. Blipper's fine the way it is now. Let's check the transmission panel. I want to make sure all these panels are cleaned up. Okay, so this one has some... This one can be minified a little bit there. Update that. Now, probably when you move stuff, you generally have to reconnect them, so we'll have to reconnect. Let's check all the composite, make sure the composite didn't get screwed up. What is this? This is 2 transmission. What is that? Seat. Okay, we don't need 2 transmission anymore because... Do we? No, we do. 2 transmission. Why is this screwed up? What did I screw up here? Seat goes to seat. Okay. Transmission. Okay, no, that's fine. It doesn't come... Nothing reads the transmission anymore, so that can actually go. Because the seats plug into the transmission, so I don't need that anymore. Logic. Where's 2 transmission? All right, and do I need anything else? Starter, alternator, battery, RPS, pump clutch. I'm going to put the brakes on here. That way that will help people with brakes. So let's go Composite, nope, number, output, variable, breaks. Okay, that'll make it a little easier for people. You don't have to put a brake controller in here. So if we go from transmission, that's going to come up here and 2. Right here is 2, right? So what we want to do is we want to do function, negative x. So when we're going forward, it's going to read a positive x. That would apply the brakes. So when we're going forward, it's going to read now a negative x. And that's going to take the brakes off. When we start to press the S key, this is going to go negative, which will read positive, which will apply the brakes. So simple variable brake controller there. And so that we can plug in. All right, variable brakes, brake, brake. And I think I'll leave the wheels on here just so that everybody can work with it. All right, so I think this is pretty good, I think. So let's save it really quick before I screw around with it. All right, so let's say I want to make this a truck and I added more weight. I talked about this before of going into the chart. So it's very simple what you would have to do if you were to try to reduce all these gear ratios. So let's say you wanted to make it a truck. If you look at my, where is it? My gear 3 here is pointing towards, it's pointing away from the engine. This lowers the gear ratio. Let's say I wanted to drag all these and make all these a bigger number, which means I have a lower gear ratio, more torque. This 6.5 now turns into a 3.2, and I've just added a quarter of a gear ratio to that. Now I need to do all of them, because remember, 3 only has the one ratio because the other one's reverse. And notice, see how they all get lower? Every gear just got lower. So if you're having a problem where you're stalling, where you can't haul any weight, you want to add a trailer, you want to make it a truck, that's all you do. Drop those down a gear, and now we're up. Is it still not enough? Go to the next one. 9.5. Bingo. We just went from 3 to 4.5 by dropping two ratios. 3 to 3.75 to 4.5. And then 9.5. And they all work. So you see how it's that simple to change all your ratios up or down. So here's 9.5. Okay. Let's say, so we were at a 6.5 before. Let's say that, okay, my gear ratios are too low and I don't need them that low. We could change that to a 1.5 because it was at a 6.5 initially. So see, they all walked down, went from a 3 to a 2.5, went down to a 1.66 from a 2, 1.33 to a 1.11. What was that? That was like a 1. That was a 1 down to a 0.83, and this was a 0.66 down to a 0.55. So that's how you can very dynamically change the boxes without changing much. We change one number and we can raise or lower it. That is the reason why I've decided this is the best way to do it. Have 3 as my down gear and then 4 is my up gear. So if I wanted to go even higher, I could go ahead and I could change 4. And so that makes it nice and simple. So let me just quickly read through chat. No, it shouldn't need any adjusting. You'll probably need more starters, but that's fine. It should work. Sometimes you get an issue with exhaust on the larger engines, but that's just adding more exhaust pipes, really. It should work on all of them. Shouldn't be a problem. You do get an issue where, for example, let me show you something. So let's say we want to get rid of this, this flywheel. So let's just do this. Let me load up this one. All right, so let's say you want to take out the flywheel. All right, so let's look at the engine box. So right here, p-value for engine, 0.18. This number sometimes has to change if you have a flywheel. Remember, an object at rest wants to stay at rest. An object at motion wants to stay at motion. When you add a flywheel, you're adding a big, heavy mass, and the whole point of that is so that the object does not want to change speed very fast. It doesn't want to get going very fast, and it doesn't want to get slow down very fast. That's why for a truck you usually put a flywheel on, or a big flywheel. You don't want to be able to, you don't want real dynamic changes there. So if you have a car here, let's just do this, and you remove this And now we have no flywheel. All I just did was put a crank there. This still most likely will work, but you may have to tune that p-value. This p-value works pretty well, I think, so you may not need to. This car should be zippier without the flywheel. So I'm able to switch gears a little bit faster. I'm able to change speed a little bit faster because I don't have to worry about spinning up the flywheel. Flywheel keeps you in motion. It's good for trucks because, you know, you start going up a hill and your engine has so much momentum because the flywheel is heavy. It helps you get up the hill, but it takes you more time to change. So you can take that flywheel out if you want. I'll probably release both versions, but you see that p-value works fine with that. I'm having no issues. Sometimes your flywheel may cause issues. So, but as you can see, this one, it's fine. I actually won't save it. I'll just upload the other one. Let me see. Okay, let me check in some chat here. Yeah, so it should work fine with 3x3s and 5x5s. Shouldn't have any issue. Diesel electric truck Edison motors, do you think that the losses involved would negate the benefits? I think it would negate the benefits, but if it's something you want to do, do it. You know, that's kind of the thing. You have a lot of losses with diesel electric. I do diesel electric for all my, or not all of my, I do diesel electric for some of my construction vehicles that have tracks because it's easier to run the tracks with electric motors. It's not as efficient. And you know, some of the things that make it efficient in real life, for example, when you're driving a truck around and you're parked at a stoplight and you're going through city traffic, you burn a lot of diesel for no reason. You're not moving. That's an issue with trucks. The other one is you have to rev up to get peak torque. So in real life, you get peak torque instantly. So it is beneficial to have a truck that's diesel electric because you have peak torque right off the bat. You don't have to rev up. And that is also beneficial. The other thing is you can do very minute speed changes with an electric motor. So you can very gently put it on door, back it onto a dock. You can go down a hill, up a hill very easily. So those are all the benefits. We don't have any of those benefits in game. The other one is regenerative braking, where you're going down a mountain with a truck, you just start doing regenerative braking, you're gaining back all that electricity, and you're helping to slow down the truck without wearing out your brakes. None of these things we have in game, so I find it is not really useful. You do it if you want to do it. It's not really helping. What kind of gearbox are you making? Just a four-speed kind of a car. Gearbox. But so this is, let's see. So I think this is how it will look. You know, it should be pretty easy. I'm just, you know, it has wheels on there for people to screw with, but, you know, just so that they know where to hook things up. But again, people can, you know, this is going to be in the workshop. I'll try to get it on tonight. We'll see. I need to make another video quickly showing how to hook it up and everything, and I don't feel like doing that right now. But I'll put this up. I put the 10 and the 18 speed on last night, so those are on. There's a video explaining how to put those on your trucks. But, you know, so hopefully that's helpful to people. I would like to get a proper gearbox transmission out, but you can see how it's dense. And it's like I have to explain to people how a chart like this works. And you see how useful this chart is. Most people just go in there and they just literally 100% randomly just switch gears. And they're like, oh, we're going slower. I'll just change it again. They don't take the time to do this. This is so much easier. You know, okay, this isn't low enough. Okay. That's going the wrong direction. Okay, so I need to go the other way. Okay, good. So that's lower. Okay, that's better for a truck. See how easy that is? I can quickly change these out and bingo. All right, so let's say like a box truck is like a 7-to-1 gear ratio. Okay, how do I get a 7-to-1 out of this? Okay, 6-to-1, okay. 5-to-1, okay, that was the wrong direction, okay. Hey, there we go, done. You know, so you could be in game flipping around gearbox, starting your engine, try drive, and nope, doesn't work. Or you could go in here and in a couple seconds, I just changed everything. And it works. And so this is what I would recommend. Highly recommend doing this. You know, that's going to be the best way. And now I need to fix what I screwed up. But this is definitely my preferred way of doing gearing. As you can see, I can very quickly change. And then because I saved this as a Google Sheet, If I need to start with a truck, I'll come up and I'll check some numbers and I'll find a truck that I want. I don't think I did. I do the tow truck. I don't know if I did. Let me check it. Here, small tow truck right here. Notice the small tow truck, 7.5 gear ratio, 7.5, 6, 3, 6, 1, 8. 1, 8's the lowest. It's only a 4-speed transmission. That's my truck gearbox for my tow truck that I built not too long ago. And why is it so low? Because it needs to be able to tow a car. So it works really well. I tow a car. It doesn't even know the car is there because it has about double the torque. Because all you're doing is you're trading RPS for torque. You're saying, okay, I want less RPS, which is speed, for more power. And so the higher this number gets, the more power you have, the less speed you have. That's it. And if you made this 18-speed gearbox like my tractor trailers are, guess what? You can have both. You have an absolute insane amount of power. Low, I can haul a quarter million pounds of oil, no problem, like it's nothing. Or you can go, you know, I have a governor. My tractor will go 120 miles an hour if I didn't put a governor on there. But it has a governor that makes it go no more than 65. And so it will go 65 miles an hour at max, whether it has a huge load or not. I think actually if I have the 250,000 pounds on, I can only go about 60 miles an hour. I can only go up to 16th gear. Because guess what? It doesn't have the torque to pull that weight at that speed in 17 or 18. They're too high. You know, and then you go to my 10 speed. Where is the... check the Eatons out here. Like that's Eaton 10 speed. This one I can go faster than I can go on my 10 speed. Because the 10 speed... Where is it? Somewhere up here. I don't know where to put the 10 speed. 10 speed's a lot older. And then guess what has more versatility than a 10-speed? A 13-speed. You know, so that's why you have so many gears, is the smaller the change of the range of the gear, the more likely you can go uphill. For example, I have a lot of experience driving, you know, heavy tractor trailers up hills. And in a car, you can go up that hill at 65. In the truck, I'll start the bottom of the hill at 65, and by the time I'm at the top of it, I'm at 45. I have to go from 10th down to 9th. Down generally, probably maybe 8th. If I have a really heavy set of doubles, I'd have to go down to 8th gear. And so you need all those gears to be able to go up in your car. You'll stay in the highest gear the whole way up. Why? Because the car doesn't weigh anything. And so you never need to change because the car doesn't weigh anything. The truck can, you know, and then if I go bobtail, bobtail means without a trailer. If I go bobtail, it's 65 all the way up the hill, no problem. Because guess what? There's no load back there. So that's why you have all those gears. And so I've seen, people can build whatever they want, of course, but I've seen some people build trucks and they've like, some of them have said critical things towards like one of my trucks. They'd be like, oh, you don't need all those gears. It's like, you may not need all those gears, but I do, because I actually use my trucks like trucks. I go up and down all the hills in game with very heavy weights, no problem. And it's because it's built the way it is in real life. And so I highly recommend, look at the gear ratios online. If you're going to build a box truck, I look at the Eaton Fuller. Let's see if I can actually find it. We're still on the Eaton page. Here's the, let me find it. They changed the website out, which was really annoying. Let's see if I can find it. Eaton 6-speed medium duty transmission gear ratios. Because this might bring me to the exact page. Just do it. Oh my God, what is this? See, like now they're putting in all the security nonsense that is like trying to make it harder to find. That's friggin' annoying. This one might show them. There it is. All right, so this is a chart. This shows you, this is a medium trans, this is a Eaton Fuller 6-speed transmission. I've literally driven this in real life. And this will show you what the ratios are. So first is a 9, 5, 3, 2, 1, 3. And six gear is a 1-to-1. This one is a different model. It's a 7-4-5 with 4 to a 2-8-1-8-2-9-1. And then sometimes you'll get an overdrive where if you go down here, these here, these will go down even lower, down to like a 0.78 so they can go faster, you know. And so that is, you know, this tells you all your ratios. So start here because it's simple math. If the engine is turning at a certain rate and you're putting it through the multiplication of the gearbox and your wheel is a certain size, you will get a certain speed. And so there are a couple ways to go faster. Make your tire bigger. If you make your tire a larger size, one rotation takes you a longer distance. All right, so pretty simple to show you that really quick. So you have a tire, right? Tire is a circle. If you cut your tire, right, and you get the radius of your tire, right, and you were to lay that line out, right? I don't want a circle anymore. Let's get a line. And so if we cut our tire and we laid it out, that's the radius of your tire, one rotation will take you this long. If you rotate this in 1 second, right? So let's say you go this way. So this is how far you're going to go in 1 second, right? So if your tire's turning at 10 RPS, you're going 10 meters per second, right? You're going 19.4 knots, 2.38 miles per hour, it'd be 23.8 miles an hour for every, what did I say, 10 rotations, something like that. I can't even remember now. And so you know your gear ratios. If you're in first gear and your engine can go 10 RPS and you have a 2-to-1 gear ratio on there, your tire's only going to go at 5 RPS. And if this is 1 meter long, you're now going 5 meters per second, you know, so that tells you, so you're going, what would be half that? So it'd be 11.5 miles an hour. So that's how you can tell what speed you're going to get. And so it's simple math. And that's why, like, you know, I'll tell people, you know, go online, find real gear ratios, you know, cheat a little bit, but use real gear ratios for your transmissions. And they'll be like, game sucks. It's not realistic. Why bother? And it's like, dude, it doesn't matter how realistic the game is. It's math. You're still turning the tire at a certain rate. And if you turn the tire at a certain rate, the tire is a certain diameter, you're still going to go a certain speed. And so you can guess what speeds you're going to go. Now, we get into issues in game where, for example, if you slip the wheel, well, guess what? Your wheel is now not turning to move you. It's turning to make smoke. And so you're losing that efficiency. And you'll often see people who have issues with their builds in game spinning up the tires. And like I was saying before in the video, your tire will spin up if you have too much torque, which is what happens in real life, right? You rev up your engine, you drop your clutch, it causes the tire to spin up, you lose traction, and you're spinning your wheel up. That's how it happens in real life. If you put too high of a gear ratio in, what will happen is you will stall in real life. In game, you will spin the tire. And so you'll see people going 100 miles an hour spinning their tires, and they'll get confused. And one thing, you need to add more weight to get it to push down on the ground. You need to add more downforce with wings. Or you need to get the proper gear ratio so your tire is turning at the right speed for the right RPM. Because there's a critical coefficient of friction in game where at that friction, your tire is going to lose grip. And if you have the right gear ratios, your tires won't be spinning all the time. Currently my best performing car. Let's grab that. It's a Vice car. Vice car has the best performance. And you'll notice, I'll show you some things, how you can figure out why you're spinning when you're spinning. This one does not spin a ton. Somebody asked for, who asked for the, who asked me for the steering controller? Somebody asked me for that. So this here, this has two horns. My brakes on my brakes room. Paper Muffin, are you on my Discord? Okay, here, let me quickly send you a link. If you can go in there and put in the Discord that, just remind me in the, I have a thing, where is it? Here it is, I'm trying to find it here. Let me find it. It's, a video request. Just stick it in there. I'll send you this invite here really quickly. And just ask for the steering controller, and I will get that wrapped up and put it on. But for example, this has the steering controller in it. But watch my tires. They don't squeal for very long. They'll always squeal in a turn because you lose traction. But I downshifted. So now, see they stop squealing? Upshift. In real life, they would never do that. They would never squeal on an upshift. There's my downshift. There's my downshift. Downshift. Upshift. I can squeal at an upshift. Now notice they didn't squeal for very long. And the reason is because I have the correct ratio so that the wheel is not exceeding the coefficient of friction. Ah! I was doing everything possible to steer around that. I was like, oh, I'm gonna go on the inside of it. Well, like here, I'll show you the steering controller is best on this. Now, some things with you still have to set up your build stably, so what I do is I measure between the two wheels and I get my center of gravity right 50-50 split. That's going to help you have stability. But the wheel controller also helps. So let's do that. My power's not on. All right. So like here, I'll show you the stability on this. So here we are in first gear. Notice, not a lot of spinning. It's going to spin on a turn, but I can make my turns pretty predictably, and it's because the pit is controlling the wheels, and so I can very quickly get into and out of a drift. So I'm going to hit the building, get out of the drift, and it takes over and it like smooths the motion. But see, on these upshifts, we would never have a tire squeal in real life. You wouldn't have the torque. You're losing torque. You're converting your torque to RPS. And so you might be able to, if you have like a Hellcat or something, you might be able to get it spin up. You'll get it in like some really high performance cars. Okay, so watch this. Watch me smoke, and I'll show you how to get rid of it. Let go of the W key, smoke goes away. What that tells you is that's telling you that you're turning your wheel too fast for your gear ratio. And that's causing you to lose grip. And so what you want to do is you want to come off the W key for a second. Off the W, it did itself there. Off the W key, smoke goes away. That's telling you that that gear ratio is probably too high. And the only reason I haven't made it lower is I don't want a 7-speed. I want, I think this is a 5-speed. I think it's a 5-speed. I didn't want to put an extra gearbox in there. If I did, it wouldn't smoke like that. So, you know, it's up to you. Like, it will always smoke in a turn for... because you're drifting, you know, you're squealing the tire sideways, but that will smoke for a second. So that gear right there, that's my top gear. That gear should come down a little bit, and I should add a sixth gear, but I don't want to add an extra gearbox in there because I don't have the space. So I just say, oh, I don't care if it smokes for a second. You know, so that's kind of like there. We're going to smoke for a while. I'm going to keep oscillating. So we smoke, take my finger off the W key, smoke's gone, back on the W key. And all you were doing is you were overspeeding your tire. So that's something that happened in the game where you're able to easily break coefficient of friction where IRL you wouldn't. And so this is what the steering control allows you to do, is it allows you to like do these nice long drifts. And if you get crazy, like see, it's not letting me get crazy. So it kind of helps me not get too crazy there. And if I get really crazy, I just let go and it will fix it for me. My hands are off. And so I'll show you the steering controller really quick. So it's really super simple. I'll release it at some point. Just remind me there. Where the hell? Okay, it's up here in this one. So here's the steering controller. Pretty simple. If you look at, you have your seat. AD is 1. You go into a PID. You then take an angular speed. You get an angular speed sensor. I'll show it to you in the car. You should put it at the center of gravity. That's where your car is going to pivot from. And then you want to work on your p-value to try to get your p-value where you want it. This one I have a 0.75. I do a constant on. You could also trigger it if you want, but I don't want to have to put an extra node in there. This goes out to my starboard wheel. The regular node comes off of the PID, goes out to the starboard steering wheel. I do a negative X to invert the steering on the port side. And then you have your port steering is just inverted. If I flip the wheel upside down, it doesn't like to behave as much. That's why I invert it. I could flip the wheel upside down, but for some reason it oscillates, so I tend to just invert it. But that's pretty simple. It's a really simple controller. You have to play with that number, but for example, like me check out one of my other cars here. This car here, this one has the identical steering controller with identical numbers. This one does not weigh as much, and so it's less stable, and it has less mass pushing down on the wheels. I just accidentally hit my directional, which is gonna be a pain to shut off. And so this one skids more than the Vice car. It's not too bad, but it's a little bit less stable than the Vice car. The Vice car is a lot heavier. It gets more grip on the tires. Actually, I might have fixed it. Yeah, it looks like I fixed it. I did fix it. Okay. So like, say this has the same steering controller in there. This one's a little less stable just because it doesn't weigh as much as the Vice car. The Vice car is reasonably heavy. Vice car has also got a much more powerful engine than this. So it's actually kind of cool too, is watch this. I'll get the wheels spinning again. One thing you can also do to get those wheels to stop spinning, drop a gear. And your wheels will catch up to the speed they're supposed to be going, and you'll grab that traction again. So it's just essentially the game is allowing you to spin your wheels up when you should be stalling your engine. That's kind of the long and the short of why they constantly smoke. And like I showed you can do that test. Get them smoking a straight line, take your finger off W for a second. Does it stop right away? Yep, you're in too high of a gear. And so that will tell you, okay, try to drop it down a little bit. So like, I think my high gear in the Vice car is 0.55. I'm gonna actually look it up and show you guys. And I'll end here in a second. I need to bring it back up. I close the sheet. I just find it really quick. There it is, gearing. All right, so here I'll show you the sheet again. So if I look up the Vice car, so here's the Vice car. So if you look at the gear ratio, it goes all the way down to a 0.55. That is a really high gear. That means for every one row, for every 0.55 rotations of the engine, I'm getting one rotation of the wheel. And so that is a lot. And so that's why this one will spin up. If I went from 0.83 to say like a 0.66 to a 0.55, I probably wouldn't get that spin up. Eventually, your car is going to have to be much heavier, or else you're always going to spin up. You just can't go to infinity with this. You'll end up spinning up your tires. You have to get more weight on the car, and so you're adding weight, and that's just a thing of the game. Is the car the wheels are designed to break grip so that you don't stall your engine all the time, I think. So, no, I have no problem with performance. I don't play much or any multiplayer, but like we used to do the Workbench podcast, which I'm sad that that's gone. But we used to do the Workbench podcast. There would be six of us with a lot of builds. Endo always had on some sub hunt add-on, which was using up a ton of resources, and we usually had no problems. I think a lot of it is people have poor connections. They're trying to play with people who are too far away geographically. You're hosting the whole session on your PC, so if you don't have a good enough PC, you're gonna have issues with that. But I have no problem running all these PIDs, and I get no lag on them. And the other thing too is, like somebody went on and was talking about one of my I think my module engine tutorial. They're like, oh, I went in and I changed a bunch of your PID values, and now it works perfectly. And it's like, somebody who's been driving, probably has a million miles driving. A real truck that operates IRL right now is nowhere near that as accurate as I get them in game. You don't need it. It doesn't need You don't need to be within 0.001 RPM of what you set. No truck is going to be like that. If you have a cold day, your RPM is going to be different than if you're on a hot day by larger margins. You don't need that level of accuracy. You saw I put in that P value. I had no I, I had no D. I wanted 20 RPM, and it gave me 19.556. That is more than close enough. And guess what? If I really wanted 20 super bad, I would have gone to 21 and I would have had it, So that's my preferred method, is just step up your desired RPM, leave the P value at a nice non-oscillating level, and it's so much easier. All right, guys, I think I'm gonna go take my walk. Hope you guys found that helpful. I'm gonna try to get this out soon. I need to wrap it up, make a whole new video on that. Just have people how to hook it up and stuff, because this is, again, this is for, this is kind of reaching out to the audience who's kind of new, And who wants to just drop in an engine and transmission combo? Somebody had asked for this, so I'll put out two versions. I'll put out one with the flywheel, one without the flywheel. It doesn't really matter where the flywheel's sitting on this build. It's not in the way. But yeah, so I plan on, I'm trying to drop out more of these modules. So like, I showed you guys how you could very quickly and easily in like 2 seconds change this from a car to a truck. You know, I'll release a truck version. It'll literally take me 2 seconds to do. It's just like, again, you know, I showed you guys how easy it was to change this into a truck. Okay, I want a truck. All right, grab this. Copy this. Transmission tutorial. It's all in this. Truck. Go to gear 3. Okay. 3-2. Okay, maybe that's not enough. Okay, 9-5. 9-5. 9-5. 9-5. Just change all of these on 3 to a 9. And now we have ourselves a pickup truck. Okay, I want something that's not a pickup truck. I want something that's a more heavy duty truck. Change all these to 5-2. Change all these to 5-2. Bingo. We now have a box truck. We're not going to go 100 miles anymore. We're going to go 80 miles an hour. And guess what? We can haul a ton of weight. That's it. And that's why I use a chart like this, is it takes me like no time getting my transmissions changed over, because you saw, that's all I did was change one number in the 3 box. That's my reverse. And if I want to go high, if I want to go lower, I change 3. If I want to go higher, I change 4. And I can move my boxes dynamically up and down, up and down, up and down. And now we have, oh, this one screwed up here for some reason. Oh, because I put a 5 instead of a 2. And you see, so we went from a 3-1 to a 6-5, which is now more in the truck realm, to a 4, to a 2, to a 2, to a 1.38. That's still going to give us good speed. I can figure out the speed there. If we were going, you know, we could tell, you know, if I had the wheel diameter, the radius of the wheel, we could figure that out in 2 seconds. But you see, it's easy to do that. And that will change your speed. You'll have a lower high speed because instead of turning it, you know, multiplying out the RPM of the wheel, you're now reducing it, but you're getting more torque. So now you can have a truck. And so it's really simple. Throw that. You saw, if that's still not low enough, I have one more gear ratio I can go. Actually, I have multiple gear ratios I could go. But so some people will tell you, you can do this with fewer gearboxes. You can. Absolutely. 100%. Why do I use 4? Why do I use 4 in everything but my actual, like my tractor trailers? I use 4 in all of those because this allows me to take 4 and turn it into almost every gearbox that I need. And right here. Okay, my truck's not hauling enough weight for me. Now we have a 7-5, a 5, a 3, a 2-5, and a 1-6. And we actually didn't lose much speed at our top gear. Let's say that's still not low enough. Well, guess what? 4 can now be a... Nine, one, six, one, six, one. This one I'd have to play with. 3-1, 3-1. So these I'd have to play with, but I could screw with those to get those. 6-1 here. 3-1, 2-1. So yeah, I could play with those to get that ratio fixed out. You know, and so you can see how quickly this one's gonna screw me up because I have duplicates and stuff. But you see how easy it is to go from car to a truck, truck to a car. Okay, I want a really fast car that's super duper light that doesn't need a really low gear ratio. I can just up gear them all. And so a chart like this, I highly recommend. All it is doing is multiplying your fractions for you so you don't have to do it. And super easy. But yeah, so I hope you guys found that helpful. I'll release these soonish. I need to, you know, just do a little video on them that's quickly how to hook them up. And that's it. And, you know, I'm trying to release more of these, but I'll release a truck. When you saw it, it took me all of 2 seconds to do it. All I did was change gear ratio 3. So all I have to do is go in here to 3. And where's 3? 3 is right here. And up, that just turned into a truck. Spawn it. Now let's see. Does it behave like a truck? It does. You know, start it. Alright, so we should expect first gear is going to be much slower now. And we'll top out at a much slower speed. Before we were going, I think, 26 miles an hour. Now we're going about 10 miles an hour. So we're going to go much slower in each gear, but we have a lot more power. Remember, we're trading our power for more speed. You don't get anything for free. You either trade your speed for power or power for speed. So now we have a truck. This right here should be able to haul a lot of weight. Not as much as my, like, I'll show you this sucker. This is my weight hauler here. This is the one that hauls 250,000 pounds. No problemo. I'm in the wrong thing here. Where am I? Turn around. There we go. Come on, get in there, you. Here's like one of my 18 speed. Here's the 18 speed pinnacle. This hauls 250,000 pounds like it's nothing. You know. And the reason is, like, this is the gearbox. It has a low speed and has a high speed gearbox. It has, what is it, 1, 2, 3, 6, 7 gearboxes in there? So this is 7 gearboxes. Could I do it with a lower number of gearboxes? Sure. Do I want to? No. Because, you know why? Because of the real engine, this is what it looks like. You know, and so this one here, let's see if I can show you the engine. So I put a flat 6 in that car engine, right? You want more power? Add more cylinders. This one is 1, 2, 3, 5. This is a 20. So this is a 20 cylinder engine. And so the gearbox is actually doing most of the work. Could I do this with a 6 cylinder and probably get pretty close results? Yeah. The 20 is just going to give me a lot more grunt. And so I take this thing with 250,000 pounds up and down the mountains in game, no problem, because of the gearbox. The engine doesn't really matter all that much. The gearbox is what's doing the work. It's converting all that RPS into torque, and it's getting me up and down the hills. And so you see how that's so gearing, I know, is kind of it's a challenging subject, but hopefully, you know, you guys find that easy, interesting. But it's not, you know, I see people try to do it in a 5-minute video, and it's just going to confuse people. You need to understand the fundamentals of why this thing works to actually make it work. And, you know, I hope I kind of impressed a couple times of like, oh, you want to change? You know, I think I showed you guys that, you know, for example, that clutch was coming in too slowly. How to change your clutch speed. If you understand why the thing works, you understand how to fix it. For example, if sometimes I get my builds, I still have them in the career build series. When I go to stop, it stalls. Let's see if this one will stall. I'll kind of show you how to fix that. So let's say you get a stall noise, or it will be a restart noise. I have auto restart on this because I did hook the wheels up, right? The brakes, I did. Okay, so I hooked the brakes up, right? So what's going to happen was when you press the brakes, it should be zeroing the clutch out. Sometimes it doesn't do it fast enough. So if you understand that all that's happening is it's not zeroing the clutch fast enough, you need to have it try to zero the clutch earlier. So let's go first gear and slam the brakes. All right, so it didn't do it. So here out, it did not try to restart the engine. It didn't stall. Let's make it stall. So you'll hear this sometimes in some of my engines. So let's see. Disengage clutch application RPS right here. All right, this factor here, you can change it. Let's say I do it at 2.6. At 2.5, the starter should engage, right? That's super close. That's within 0.1. See if we can't get this to make that starter noise. So this means we're actually stalling the engine if I do this. So I'm going to slam the brakes, see if I can stall the engine. I still can't do it. This thing doesn't weigh enough. I could probably do it. Let's go down to 2.5. This will definitely do it now because it's going to trigger the starter. But this thing doesn't weigh anything, so it doesn't have enough resistance on the gearbox. So let's go forward. I'm trying to stall it. I'm not going to be able to probably. Nope, can't stall it. So I can't stall it because it's set up right. But yeah, like, so you see, I can even dial this in even closer. Like, so let's do like, I'm going to put it back up to 4 just because. Oh, you know what it is? It's right here. I did the wrong number. This one right here is what I need to fix. So the clutch zero RPS, this prevents it from stalling. So when the engine gets below, I think it's 2 or 2.5. I usually do 2.5. That's why I can't remember. But if the engine goes too low, it's going to stall. So let's put that right at 2.6. This was the one I meant to change. And I should be able to get that stall sound. So if you ever hear that in my career build series, when I slam on the brakes, it makes that stall sound. It's not stalling really. It's triggering the restart on the engine. And so all I need to do is change that one number and fix it. So if you understand why that problem is happening, you can fix it yourself. And you can make some more advanced creations. Let's slam the brakes. That noise right there. So if you ever have that problem, what it is your engine, you're not zeroing the clutch fast enough. So in real life, this happens. When you first start learning manual transmission, when you go to stop, you need to put in the clutch and the brake at the same time. And that's disengaging the wheels, which are trying to be stopped from the engine, which is still needs to spin. If you don't put your foot on the clutch, what's going to happen is the wheels are stopped now, right? Your brakes are holding the wheel. The ground is holding your wheel. The engine still wants to spin, and you still have the clutch plates pressed together. Well, guess what's going to happen? The engine needs a certain amount of speed turning to maintain compression. You now put a brake on the engine. The engine cannot get its compression. It cannot ignite the fuel, and the engine stalls and stops, and you have to restart. And so this number here, the clutch zero RPS, drag that up to 3. That difference between a 0.5 and a 3 is enough. It gives it enough time for you to put your foot on the clutch, essentially. So that's what the auto clutch is doing, is it's adding the clutch, it's reducing the clutch, and it's also zeroing the clutch all by itself. And so that's why, you know, you'll hear my vehicle sometimes stall in the career build series. It's just because I haven't gone in there and played with my numbers. And that's one of the reasons why I'm making this microcontroller, is I can go in there now, and if it stalls in career build series, I just quickly go in here without ever going in the microcontroller, change that one number, and it fixes it. All right, guys, thank you for watching. Did you put that, before you go, did you put that in the thing? Okay, video request. Okay, thank you. Yeah, so, I'll do that at some point. I'll do a little tutorial video on how to make that. And, again, I try to go in a little bit more detail. So, like, some of my cars, you need to change the P-value. If your wheels are wobbling, you need to change the P-value. So I'll get in there and actually make a video and put it in the workshop. But I showed you real quick how it works. So thank you guys for watching. I appreciate that. I hope you found that helpful and informative. I will get these on the workshop hopefully soon. I just need to wrap them up, make a video for them, and get them out there. So thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. If I usually don't ask, but if you guys give it a thumbs up and a like, I appreciate that. If you're not subscribed, please subscribe. And also, I love to see your guys build on the Discord. Discord has been super duper quiet. If you check out any of my videos, usually in the description, there's a link to the Discord. Go ahead and, join the Discord, put up some of your builds in Creation Showcase. People put their pets on there. You know, the Discord has been kind of dead lately. I always like to see people put their builds on there, and you can ask for help as well. So the more people on there, the more likely you can get some help. So, see you guys later. Really appreciate you guys, and we'll see you later. Bye. Mm-hmm.